One of our stories after Tiger Baseball.
The following is a presentation of ABC Sports. This year, from Sarajevo, Yugoslavia to Los Angeles, California, the ABC Olympic tradition continues.
1 week ago tonight, the Detroit Tigers took on the Toronto Blue Jays on the season premiere of Monday Night Baseball with Tiger shortstop Alan Trammell in the thick of the action. In the seventh inning, with Toronto leading 3-0, Howard Johnson came to the plate, hit a three-run homer into the right field foul pole screen to tie the game. The game then moved to the bottom of the 10th inning. Dave Bergman was the batter, and the crowd was looking for a hero. The plea was answered when Bergman hit that home run on the 13th pitch after fouling off seven straight, hitting one into the upper deck to give Detroit the win in the exciting beginning of Monday Night Baseball for 84. Same two clubs tonight. ABC Sports presents Monday Night Baseball. Tonight, the two top clubs in the American League East, Detroit against Toronto. And this time, the scene shifts to the shores of Lake Ontario, Toronto, Ontario, Exhibition Stadium. Well, last year, the Blue Jays were in the pennant race for the first time ever. Big crowds flocking to Exhibition Stadium. A big crowd will look on tonight as the Blue Jays come in off the road to take on the Detroit Tigers in the first game of a three-game series. A look at the standings as we begin play on the 11th day of June. On top, Detroit, after that sensational start, they're 7 in front of the Blue Jays and the defending world champion Orioles in third place, 11 games back. Hello again, everyone. I'm Al Michaels, and since we last visited with you last Monday night, Dave Bergman hitting that dramatic home run in the 10th inning, the Blue Jays wound to win two of the final three games in that series. So they wound up splitting the four-game series in Detroit, but then Toronto went into Yankee Stadium over the weekend, and the Yankees swept them. So the Blue Jays come home, come in off the road tonight, having lost four straight. Detroit, meanwhile, went into Baltimore. They beat the Orioles on Friday night, lost on Saturday, swept a doubleheader yesterday to win 3 out of 4. So Detroit has gotten hot again, and after that sensational start, their lead is a pretty comfortable 7 games with Baltimore 11 back. By the way, we're here tonight, and some of you perhaps tuned in expecting to see the Mets against the Pirates, which was the listing in the publications in perhaps your area, but we have opted for this one in light of the fact we're taking a look at the two teams with the best records in all of baseball here in the middle of June. Last month, Jim Palmer was released by the Baltimore Orioles, but we've picked him up, and he's here with us tonight as part of our Monday night crew. And Jim, as we take a look at the pitching matchup tonight, it's an interesting one with Luis Leal undefeated on the mound for Toronto against a man who's been sort of an enigma for Detroit, Dave Rosma, making an infrequent start for them.
Well, that's right, Al. Dave Rosma has not pitched as a starter since late April. And, of course, not a lot of pressure on him, having Detroit won the doubleheader yesterday and having a tremendous weekend against the Orioles in Baltimore. Luis Leal, 6-0 on the year, probably one of their best pitchers to this date, along with Dave Steep, is probably a very must game for the Toronto Blue Jays to win. I think this is a test of character. Last year, their first winning season in the American League, they finished fourth. They almost have to win tonight to stay in the race. They at least have to win 2 out of the next 3 ball games. So it should be an interesting game. They have the best pitcher on the mound against a guy that's been pitching infrequently. And we'll just have to see how long Dave Rosma can pitch.
By the way, I can't let you go without asking you about your future, the conjecture about the fact that you may come back, that you may not be at all finished, even though you're wearing the blue jacket right now. What's going to happen the balance of the year with you?
Well, I got a phone call the day after I was released from Earl Weaver, and he said, just tell him that I told everybody that you can still pitch, and I did that, and here I am in the booth. So I don't really know what's going to happen now. I would love to pitch. It would have to be the right situation. I still feel in my heart that I can do that. A little bit frustrating thinking that you can and not having the opportunity, but I enjoy broadcasting. I'm going to try to make the best out of that, and if I get a chance to pitch, it's just going to have to be the right opportunity.
Not only in the booth, but in the booth with, of course, one of your main men, Mr. Weaver. Did you really tell people that Palmer could pitch to keep him out of the booth?
I saw Palmer in spring training, and he was throwing a ball just about as well as he ever did. If he just used his slider, he could go out there and get those 32 games he needs for 300.
We'll have some fun tonight. We're taking a look at a couple of teams that have been making the most of their bench strength. We talked last week during the Toronto-Detroit game about the fact that the Blue Jays have been platooning. Sparky Anderson of the Tigers would like to go with a set lineup, but he's been platooning as well. They're getting the most out of everybody, these two clubs.
Yes, they are. Not only that, but not to stand still after they got off to the best start in baseball and have a comfortable lead like they have right now in seven games. They went out and acquired a regular center fielder, a left-handed hitter in Rupert Jones. Now, this gives Sparky the option of resting Chet Lemon whenever he wants, possibly to play Rupert in left field whenever Chet Lemon plays center. But the dividend paid off when last Thursday, only a second day in a Detroit Tiger uniform, Rupert hit the ball out of the park against Jim Clancy and won him a big ball game.
Well, we'll explore this subject even further as our pregame show continues, because we'll begin a new feature, Earl Weaver on baseball. And the subject will be platooning when we come back.
This ABC Sports Exclusive is brought to you by Sears, where you'll find great values. There's more for your life at Sears. And by Wagner, the right tool for painting.
Nearly 4 hours. That's how long it took us to paint this room with a roller. Then we painted it in less than 1 hour with the new Wagner Power Roller. A living room that took nearly 7 hours. The Wagner Power Roller finished in less than 3. The Power Roller pumps paint straight from the can to the roller or to any of several optional accessories. Why waste your time painting a pan when you could be painting your walls instead? The Wagner Power Roller, the right tool for painting.
It's Sears' sizzling summer automotive sale. Get the power of Sears 60 battery, now just $49.99. Heavy-duty radial tune shocks, now $9.99 each. Two-ton floor jacks at half price. And Sears' tough new SuperGuard response radials, now at introductory savings from 20 to 30%. At Sears, we're installing confidence day and night.
There's more for your life at Sears.
It would be every manager's dream to be able to field a team like this, one in which each player can be counted on to hit with power, field his position, and run and throw with all-star ability. If this were the case, then you would never have to substitute for that player, except, of course, for injuries. A ball club like that could get me back in uniform. But seriously, no organization is going to be able to put together a team like that for obvious reasons, one of which would be payroll. What organizations strive to do today is to use more than one ball player in a position so that they can equal the output of any one of our superstars. For example, did you know that last year the Toronto catching staff of Ernie Witt, left-handed hitter, and Buck Martinez, a right-handed hitter, hit 27 home runs between them? The same number as Lance Parrish of the Detroit Tigers. But platooning isn't new. Casey Stengel platooned many, many years ago using Hank Bauer, a right-handed hitter, against left-handed pitching, and Gene Woodling, a left-handed hitter, against right-handed pitching, with much success. While I was in Baltimore, I had success using John Lowenstein, a left-handed hitter, and Gary Reinicke, a right-handed hitter, against opposite sides pitching. However, in this situation, I used Gary Reinicke also against the right-handed pitchers that he had success with in the American League. Consequently, there was a new name born, the role player. An example of a role player that comes to my mind is Jerry Royster of the Atlanta Braves, who can start a game for you at third base, who can start a game for you in left field. Also, if he's not in a regular lineup, be inserted at second base as a defensive ball player and inserted as a pinch runner. Gerald Perry, also with the same club, a first baseman outfielder, has the same abilities. Charlie Finley, when he owned the Oakland A's, tried to specialize the game even further. He signed a track star by the name of Herb Washington, whose job was only to pinch run and to steal bases. However, it proved unsuccessful because it caused a three-player move. Washington had to replace the man who got on first base, and Washington himself had to be replaced when the team went back on the field. The only specialist that has existed in baseball throughout the years is the pinch hitter, the man who can come into the ball game and change the outcome of the game with one swing. examples like Smokey Burgess and Manny Mota. And today with the New York Mets, Rusty Staub. Last week, Howard Cosell asked Detroit manager Sparky Anderson if you can platoon too much.
Yeah, I think it can be overdone. And I think at times you do overdo it because you're constantly trying to always keep everybody playing. Toronto does it extremely well, only they do it on a very solid, consistent way. They have right-handers to play against left-handers, their left-handers play against right-handers. Baltimore also does it basically with Lowenstein and Reinicke and Dower, and when Ford's healthy, with Ford. They do a lot of it. Toronto does maybe a little more, and we do it in between. But I would say yes, Howard, you could overdo it, and I think you have to watch yourself that you don't. And I do sometimes.
The final basket. Match point. The last lap. Right now, your body's thirsty for more than water. It needs thirst aid. Gatorade.
Gatorade is thirst aid for the deep down body thirst.
When you exercise, you lose more than water. You lose potassium, minerals, fluids. Gatorade puts it all back fast. It's no ordinary thirst quencher. It's thirst aid.
Gatorade is thirst aid for the deep down body thirst.
Must have 4 or 5 insurance policies. But I know I don't have a clear insurance plan.
For years, Allstate has made it easy to come in and talk and get your insurance needs worked out. That set the tone for the way the whole Sears Financial Network does business. Straightforward and down to earth. Visit a Sears Financial Network center or any Allstate office. The Sears Financial Network. Trust us to make it work for you.
East game this afternoon. The first place Cubs and the Expos were tied 1-1 in the top of the ninth. Tim Wallach's 9th home run of the season off relief ace Lee Smith won it for the Expos. We'll be updating action from elsewhere in baseball throughout tonight's game. Now let's go back to Al Michaels in Toronto.
Pitching matchup tonight as Dave Rosma on the mound for Detroit, Luis Leal for Toronto, two right-handers. Al Michaels with Jim Palmer and Earl Weaver. Stay tuned for Monday Night Baseball coming right up from Exhibition Stadium in Toronto.
An ABC News brief brought to you by Arid Extra Dry. Now from Washington, Ted Koppel.
Good evening. The United States, for the first time, has used a missile to shoot down another missile in outer space. The Pentagon says it's the first known successful test of an anti-ballistic missile system. In Moscow, Soviet President Chernenko has called for immediate talks with the U.S. on banning anti-satellite weapons. He said tomorrow may be too late. The Supreme Court today eased restrictions on police, ruling that illegally obtained evidence may be used in court in some cases. Now this.
Only Arid has this baby fresh scent.
Tough on wetness and odor.
But, baby fresh on you.
Arid Baby Fresh Spray, roll-on solid in Baby Fresh Cream.
A bill to grant amnesty to millions of illegal aliens survived a major House vote today. Tonight on Nightline, illegal immigration. Should America's borders remain open to everyone all the time? More news later on this ABC station.
Sunday, Richard Dreyfuss is a private eye tackling his toughest case, the Big Fix.
And driving can kill a friendship.
In a mileage test for 3 of America's highest octane lead-free gasolines, Amoco Premium Lead-Free delivered the best mileage.
Six Flags Auto World, a totally new world with something for everyone. The past, the future, fun stuff, scary stuff, indescribable stuff. Six Flags Auto World, leave the real world behind.
You're a whole new generation. You love and want to do. I put a pixie in the motion, and that choice is up to you. Hey, you're the best generation. Cause the diamond is the thrill of the day.
Could closing hospital be dangerous? The story tonight after the game.
Monday Night Baseball with the Detroit Tigers taking on the Toronto Blue Jays is brought to you by Chevrolet. With the performance, the style, the innovation, the quality, and the value that make up today's Chevrolet. by Budweiser, the king of beers and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you. By Sharp Electronic Corporation, from sharp minds come sharp products. And by Kodak, official film of the 1984 U.S. track and field team. Kodak film, because time goes by. This game in Toronto tonight will be the first in a three-game series between the Detroit Tigers and the Toronto Blue Jays, and it's only the 11th of June, so what that tells you is there are more than 3.5 months remaining, a lot of time left in the baseball season. A seven-game lead is not insurmountable. A lot of teams have lost seven-game leads in a lot shorter period of time, but Jim Palmer, as these two teams now meet for the fifth time in a little more than a week, how important is this series to, in particular, the Blue Jays, who are seven back here?
Well, it's very important now. Of course, they're, as you said before, on a four-game losing streak. They went to New York. They lost three in a row in New York City over the weekend. They did not get any clutch hits. They're saying to themselves right now in the locker room, we have to win tonight. We have to at least win two out of these three games to stay in the race, or at least be in a position where we feel confident as far as our ability to win. And they're going to have to go out to do it. They have their best pitcher going for them tonight, so they're in a good position to win.
Sparky Anderson has to be a happy man. I wonder, though, about Bobby Cox, who was thrown out of yesterday's game, whose team has dropped four straight. Let's face it, the 11th of June, it's much too early, Earl, for a win one for the Gipper talk, but what does a manager do at this point?
Well, all he can do is let him play baseball. I know he's concerned about losing four in a row, but seven games you can still pick up easily. One year we were seven out on Labor Day. We had Boston was in first place. We had a double header scheduled. Going out to the park, I was as nervous as I could be, knowing that if they got the split, it was going to be tough. If we lost two, I felt we were out of it. But remember, that was Labor Day, and now it's only June.
Only June, Tigers and the Blue Jays, and we'll get it underway in just a minute.
Come on, work out of it, work out of it.
He's never had anybody push him like this.
Come on, work for your base, work for your base, kid, that's it.
But if I can push him far enough, he might have a shot at a medal.
Get around, get around.
And if I can get him to push himself,
resist.
He might just take it all.
Budweiser salutes the coaches and trainers of the 1984 U.S. Olympic team.
For all you do.
This Bud's for you.
Today, the most exciting new ideas in the hotel business come from Holiday Inn.
Now, Holiday Inn is a better place to be.
It works much better.
It tastes much better.
Better and better.
Really better.
Holodex 2, the industry's first bimodal reservation system, ensures your room is waiting. Innovations like this make Holiday Inn hotels number one.
We're number one. We're worldwide hosts. First with what you want the most.
Call 800-HOLIDAY.
Holiday Inn is a better place to be.
Buy my computer.
Nay, buy my computer.
No, buy my computer.
There's one way to cut through today's computer clutter. Compare other business computers with Radio Shack's Tandy TRS-80 Model 2000. Judge the ease of operation, speed, graphics, software, and price. Compare. I believe your informed buying decision will be the Tandy 2000 personal computer. See it today at your nearby Radio Shack Computer Center. We invite comparison.
Hi, I'm Nolan Ryan. I always get a thrill from seeing baseball's great players in the All-Star Game. That's why I urge you to help choose the starting lineups for the 1984 All-Star Game in San Francisco on July the 10th. This will be the 15th year that you can vote for your favorites in baseball's All-Star election. Ballots are free at retail stores featuring an All-Star display and at major and minor league ballparks. All-Star balloting ends June 30th, so get out and vote.
The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
The Tiger lineup, as usual, has Lou Whitaker leading off. He'll be at second base. Then the league's leading hitter, Alan Trammell, comes in batting 346. Kirk Gibson hits third, and he will be the designated hitter. And the cleanup hitter tonight is the big catcher, Lance Parrish. Then Darrell Evans, in his first season in the American League, bats fifth at first base. John Grubb is the Tiger right fielder tonight, hitting sixth. Chet Lemon is in center. He's having a good season, bats seventh. The recently acquired Rupert Jones bats eighth and plays left field. And hitting ninth is the third baseman, Howard Johnson. And the Blue Jays have taken the field in the twilight with Willie Upshaw budding all-star at first base. He's having that kind of a season. And then the steady one, Damaso Garcia, who may be out-publicized by Lou Whitaker, but he's right there with him as an all-around second baseman. Alfredo Griffin is the shortstop. Number nine hitter who's hitting 255. That's not bad. Rance Mullinix at third base. He platoons there with Garth Orge. The outfield for Toronto, they platoon with Dave Collins. He and Barfield platoon. When Barfield's in there, he's in right, but Collins is in left, and Mosby is the everyday center fielder. And then around in right field, they have George Bell. When Collins is in the lineup in left, Bell plays right. When Barfield's in right, Bell goes to left. Back of the plate, platoon situation with Ernie Witt doing the catching. And the pitcher is the unbeaten Luis Leal from Venezuela, who made his major league debut in 1980 with Toronto and has been with the club
for the Tigers
since.
First base, number 53.
The umpires tonight, it will be Dave Phillips back of the plate, then Jerry Neudecker is at first base. John Hirschbeck is a rookie umpire. He is at second, and Steve Palermo is the umpire at third on just a gorgeous night in Toronto. The temperature is in the mid-70s. Cloudless sky, sun going down, back of third. And you can still see the last vestiges of sunlight as Whitaker gets set to stand in. A look around Exhibition Stadium in Toronto, built for football, a gerrymandered park. There are the dimensions, a symmetrical baseball surface, 330 down the line, 375 to the alleys, and 400 to straightaway center as the first pitch to Whitaker misses 1-0. Whitaker, in the first game of yesterday's doubleheader, scored 5 runs in Baltimore. That's one shy of the major league record. He's having a great year. He was 8-for-14 against Toronto last week.
Well, he had a great 1983 season too, and he's the perfect leadoff man for a good ball club. He makes you as a pitcher really work. If you don't throw it over the plate, he's not going to swing at it. And there you saw Leal's good fastball. Leal, as we said, 6-0. He's got all four pitches. He's got a good curveball, an excellent fastball over 90 miles per hour, good slider, and a changeup. Doesn't throw it that much, but it's effective when he does throw it.
1-2, the count on Whitaker, who hits it high in the air to left center field. Dave Collins says he'll take care of it, and does. Lou Whitaker is gone. One away here in the first inning, and Alan Trammell, who leads the league in hits with 79, and leads the league in hitting as well at 346, 2 points in front of Dave Winfield, is the batter. Leal has handled Trammell through Allen's career, but Trammell's been hot. Allen in that doubleheader yesterday had 5 hits.
With Whitaker leading off and Trammell hitting second, both of them off to good starts, 315, 346. It's no surprise that Detroit has scored 57 runs in the first inning this year in 57 games.
They got off to that great start, Earl. They were not only winning, but they were, every time you hear a partial score, seemingly leading every game 7-0 in the third inning. Hit in the air to center field. Mosby had trouble reading it, and that costs him as it will roll all the way to the fence. And with Trammell's speed, he could go all the way and probably will, but he's going to be held at third as the relay comes in from Griffin. That's questionable only in the sense that Trammell, I think, felt as he rounded second and is talking with Alex Grammis that I think Trammell thought he could have made it all the way.
Well, there was a possibility, but with Kirk Gibson coming up, 31 RBIs on third base, more than likely the infield will play back in the first inning, so it wasn't worth the gamble. We can see that Mosby got a very bad jump on the ball. His first 3 or 4 steps were backwards. And he came in, he made a mistake there. He should have just laid back and held him to a single because he couldn't get to the ball. It rolled all the way to the wall, and now Detroit has a chance to score their 58th run in the first inning in 58 games.
And the infield is back with the exception of Mullinix at third with Gibson at the plate. You can see Gibson is in the sunlight. There's just a little bit of sunlight here, and I'm wondering if that wasn't the problem with Mosby picking up the ball as it left the bat.
Well, this has always been a very difficult park for the outfielders to pick up the ball. Probably not as much now. When we first came up to Toronto many years ago, 5-6 years ago, they used to have a lot of empty seats. Tonight, with an outstanding crowd as they have, they have the metal seats here, and it's just hard to catch the fly ball going up and at this particular time. But as you mentioned also, it's tough for the left-handed hitter. because he's looking right into the sun.
Looking in from center field, you can see everything else is encased in shadow. You can see the sunlight around home plate and the light-colored shirts back of the plate. Little squibber foul, and the count stays the ball and two strikes on Gibson.
And Leal has shown a good fastball and a good slider up to this point.
Dave Steve was the man who picked that ball up. Steve lost a tough one to Guidry the other night in New York, 2-1.
Well, the book on pitching to Kirk Gibson is to try to throw him high fastballs and breaking balls out of the strike zone down and in. He did swing and missed two breaking balls. Let's see what Leal throws.
Hit foul into the Toronto dugout, into the Detroit dugout. One ball and two strikes. Sparky Anderson at the helm.
Thing about the high fastball in this situation, if he pops it up to the infield, it's a good pitch. If it goes to the outfield and a run scores, it's a bad pitch. Same pitch.
Scoring, by the way, on Trammell, a triple all the way. No error charged to Mosby. High, and count two balls and two strikes.
A little bit out of the strike zone. Good pitch. The one that Palmer was talking about.
Good look there at Gibson and where he positions himself. As far back as you can get. Outside. Three balls, two strikes, the count on Gibson.
I think something very important. Of course, the infield is playing back. They're almost conceding that run. And what that triple does just makes it a little bit more difficult to pitch in the first inning.
Gibson hits a high fly ball to medium deep right field. That is Bell positioning himself for a throw. Trammell tags, and Bell's throw is right there. But the ball comes loose. The throw had him beat, but Trammell may have taken it out of the glove of the catcher, Ernie Wynn, who was right there. What a throw by Bell.
Strong, powerful throw. It was just a little bit toward the third base side. Low breaking ball. Gibson gets just enough of it. It's going to be a close play at the plate, and we can see it coming. Good throw by George Bell. Just the least bit up the line. You'll see him reach as Trammell went by. And when Witt tried to swing and tag, the ball came out of his glove. Another angle. Just the least bit up the line where Witt had to go around. Now, if he'd have gotten away there, we might have had a dead catcher.
The batter is Parrish, who gets fooled on a breaking pitch. And the count is 0-1. So it's scored as a sacrifice fly. Gibson gets his 32nd run batted in. 1-0 Tigers. And the next pitch to Parrish is hit high in the air to left center field. Collins had trouble reading this one. Now Mosby comes over and he takes it for the out. So the outfielder is having problems here in the first, and the Tigers capitalize for a run. And after a half, it's Detroit 1 and Toronto coming up.
This is today's Chevrolet. Discover a space vehicle unlike any you've ever seen before. With an advanced new form of Earth travel, Chevrolet Celebrity Wagon. Never before has a front drive wagon touched down with this much inner space, enough for up to 8 people. Celebrity. No other front drive wagon gives you more space at a price this low. Value. That's today's Chevrolet.
People tend to confuse me with the roles I play, which is ridiculous because I'm not a neat freak. For example, I just got a Beta Zoom copier from Enalta, but not because I can add toner without getting that disgusting black powder all over my hands. No, I got a Enalta Beta Zoom because it takes this mess of different size originals and gives back copies in one neat size, automatically. But that doesn't make me a neat freak. Of course, I'm not a slob either, like,
The Beta Zoom copiers, only from the mind of Enalta.
For Toronto, Damaso Garcia, who's stolen 24 bases, is the leadoff man. Dave Collins, the switch-hitting left fielder, will bat second. Lloyd Mosby, emerging as one of the American League's big stars, hits third in center field. And another big star on the horizon, Willie Upshaw, at first base, bats fourth. Then the designated hitter is Willie Akins. He's trying to get on track. Good-looking youngster George Bell is in right field, hitting sixth. The platooning third baseman in the lineup tonight, Rance Mullenix, against the right-hander. The platooning catcher is the left-hand batting Ernie Witt, hitting eighth. And the durable Alfredo Griffin, the shortstop, hits ninth. And for the Tigers, it's Darrell Evans tonight at first base. He plays first base and also DHs. And Lou Whitaker at second. They are really tough up the middle. Whitaker's partner is the shortstop, Alan Trammell, who has scored the game's only run. And tonight, the third baseman is Howard Johnson, who's been showing some power in the past week. Rupert Jones called up from Evansville the other day, veteran major league outfielder in his first week with Detroit. Chet Lemon is the center fielder, becoming a mainstay now in Detroit. And John Grubb, who has seen quite a bit of action as the DH, gets the start in right field tonight. It's the first time he has started a game in right field this season. Lance Parrish is the Tiger catcher. And the pitcher is the fellow who had a tremendous rookie season, Dave Roseman. But when you say rookie with Roseman, you go all the way back to 1977 when he was the rookie pitcher of the year. He was 15-7, a 3.09 earned run average. But he has never come back to those figures. In fact, he has never won in double figures since his rookie season. He has had numerous injuries, shoulder, arm, and perhaps the most serious was to his knee in a fight against the Twins. And because of that fight and because of the knee problems, he wears a brace when he pitches on his left knee as he gets set to face Garcia here in the bottom of the first inning, and he starts by throwing a breaking pitch for a strike.
Quite a contrast to Luis Luau. Dave Roseman is not exactly what you would call a powerful type pitcher. He throws a lot of curveballs, drops down, but he has an excellent changeup. Doesn't walk too many guys, but doesn't strike out too many guys either.
That's been his pattern. Right now he is the extra man in the rotation for the Tigers. And the bat of Garcia is broken on a little pop out to second base. So Whitaker takes care of Garcia. And it will bring up Collins. Tigers have Jack Morris and Dan Petrie. There's two fellas they can count on not only to win, but normally to go all the way. Then Milt Wilcox and Juan Berenguer are their other two starters. They had been toying with Glenn Abbott as the fifth starter, and he did get two starts this week, but he has just been optioned out. And Sid Mangi, the relief pitcher from San Diego, was acquired yesterday, taking Abbott's spot on the roster. So they give Roseman the start tonight. Dave Collins, switch hitter, trying to get on track, as are the Jays, who come in losing four in a row. Yankees have been very tough on Toronto in the last couple of weeks, taking 5 of 6, including all three at Yankee Stadium this weekend. 1-1.
No left-handed starter. We talked about it last week. That's one of the ballparks where it can really hurt you if you go in there without a left-handed starter.
Well, it caught up with him. A couple of not particularly blasts for home runs that ended up beating him in ball games.
There's a line drive, and it's caught by Trammell before it hits the turf. So we have two down here in the first inning. By the way, neither team has a left-handed starter in this rotation.
Matter of fact, I don't believe a left-handed starter started a game for Toronto all of the 83 season.
That's right. You got to go all the way back to 1982 when Dave Geisel started a game on the 17th of August. That was the last time a lefty started for the Jays.
But you do really see that difference when you go into a place like Yankee Stadium, the short porch and right field. And those fly balls that are normally outs have hit to left, but hit to right are home runs.
1-0. Dave Bergman, who's bothered with a muscle pull, is not in the lineup. He was the man who hit the home run to end it last week, shortly before midnight in Detroit.
And it's nice when you can stick Gerald Evans in at first base in place of him.
They went out and got Evans during the offseason. Darryl made himself available in the re-entry draft and, in fact, was selected by more teams than anybody else. High drive to right center field, but it will stay in for Grubb, who has room at the edge of the track, and that's that for the Jays in the first. 3 up and 3 down for Toronto. We've played one. It's 1-0 Tigers at Exhibition Stadium. And we'll be back with more after this word from our local stations.
Parents reveal details of alleged California preschool molesting on 2020 Thursday.
The nation's highest court has decided that criminals cannot be set free because of a police mistake on a technicality. And Michigan school districts are asking voters for a lot more money. Two of our stories right after Tiger Baseball.
My boss never understood why I'd leave a terrific job to start my own diving company.
When a man has something extra deep inside his soul, it shines like a diamond, and it's worth more than gold.
It's the life I've been looking for.
So here's to the man who looks deep inside, and here's to the man who finds something extra.
Stroh's signature is something extra. You have our name on that.
There's a new gasoline that will eliminate knocking in virtually every car on the road. And it's coming. It's a gasoline that will help get top performance out of your car. And it's coming. It's the highest octane sold by any major oil company in America. And it's coming. But it's not coming from Amoco or Shell or Mobil or Marathon. It's coming from Sunoco. New 93.5 Ultra. The ultimate in octane. And you can get it now.
Tomorrow's weather, tonight on Channel 7 Action News at 11.
A lot of baseball know about the mitt Joe Morgan uses, but that even tops Morgan's. That one goes back to the Gas House Gang.
Pepper Martin used to use a glove like that, and that's why he used to stop him with his chest. He trusted his chest at third base more than he did that mitt that we just watched.
Did he use one like that?
Did I use one? When I started playing infield in the minor leagues in 1948, we used gloves where the fingers weren't laced together, but it had more of a webbing.
Here in Toronto, as we go to the second inning, a reminder that upcoming this week, coverage of the U.S. Open Golf Championship from the Wingfoot Golf Club in New York, and we'll have late night coverage for you Thursday and Friday, and then Saturday and Sunday extensive coverage beginning live at 2:30 Eastern Time. U.S. Open this week on ABC. Second inning with Darrell Evans, John Grubb, and Chet Lemon coming up for Detroit. They lead 1-0, and Evans looks at a strike. Al Michaels with Jim Palmer and Earl Weaver here.
Excuse me, Al, again. Darrell was saying, I think a lot of people always ask you what the difference between the National and the American League is. Here you see that good curveball. He said he really felt that the most difficult thing that he's had to contend with coming over from the San Francisco Giants is the high breaking ball. You just get that pitch a lot more. It makes it a little bit tougher to hit over here in the American League.
Evans in a slump, 6 for his last 50. He comes out to 120. 2 balls and 1 strike.
A veteran hitter like this will be better the second time around the league after he sees the pitchers. He'll have a little better idea of what to look for from each person that's on the mound.
Hit sharply and off the glove of Upshaw, trickling into right field. Evans gets on, and we'll see how they score it. Evans is a streak hitter.
Kind of line drive.
Carry a club for a week or so.
To the right. Has to be a base hit. It went off the end of the glove. He was off with the crack of the bat into right field.
I know it has to be, but we never know. You've seen scoring all around both leagues, and it has been scored as a base hit for Evans. As Grubb comes up, one of the reasons Grubb is in the lineup, his career against Leal.
462.
0-1 the count.
And I hate to bring this up, Jim, but how did we pitch this guy? Because he hit more than that off of you. I know he did.
We didn't pitch him the right way. John Grubb is an amazing hitter. He can get hits whether they're soft or whether they're hard.
And he hits them up or down, or at least he did against the Baltimore Orioles.
Toward left center field and headed for the gap and in the gap for extra bases. Evans will be held at third on a double by John Grubb. So Palmer can't figure out how to pitch to him, and neither can Leal.
Well, that was a pitch on the inside half of the plate.
Here you see it's a fastball, really, just about the middle of the plate, and he drives it to left center. That's one thing about John Grubb. If you pitch him in, he can pull the ball, and if you pitch him away, he's a good enough hitter to go with it.
Now, right there, we saw Evans with a chance to score, but I thought myself, I think it's a good, smart move, holding him up and keeping the big inning going. No sense in getting a man thrown out with nobody out.
Chet Lemon is the hitter. Good season thus far for Chet. Infield is back, so they'll give up a run on a ground ball, and he hits that one high in the air to deep right field. Bell did a 360 all the way back and makes the catch against the fence as both runners tag and move up. Evans scores, and the Tigers now lead 2-0 on Lemon's 40th run batted in of the season.
What a start he's off to.
So two sacrifice flies, as you can see, makes the catch against the wall with Evans scoring, Grubb going to third.
Wasn't a particularly hard play. He had room there, but he went back, saw it, had it all the way. No chance to throw the runner out at home plate or third base.
That brings up Rupert Jones, and it also brings the infield in with the score 2-0. Jones, concluding his first week with the Tigers, takes low. Boy, is he happy to be back in the majors. He spent seven seasons in the big leagues with Seattle, the Yankees, and San Diego. Went to spring training with the Pirates. They couldn't use him. Detroit signed him and sent him to AAA, and back he comes, and on a half swing hits it foul, 1-1. And you guys have seen him play through the years.
Well, many times, and type of guy that if you make a mistake, either with your breaking ball or your fastball in the middle of the plate, preferably down, he can hit the ball a long way. But he, I know, at least always impressed me as being a very exceptional athlete. I mean, he could go get the ball in center field. He had a pretty good throwing arm. And not exceptional speed, but good speed.
Jones hits it in the air to right field, falling in a hurry, and Bell can't make the play. And that will score Grubb and send Jones in ahead of the throw to second. So Grubb makes it 3-0 as he scores on a double by Jones on a ball that's sunk in a hurry.
The ball wasn't hit particularly well, and the ball really should have been caught. We get to see it again, inside part of the plate, inside the trademark, not hit hard. Bell comes in, and he's going to get this ball right at the knees, possibly a little bit below. I don't know if he's thinking about throwing a runner out on home plate on that ball or not, but he certainly should have caught the ball first before he thinks about it.
Meanwhile, activity will commence in the bullpen as Jim Acker gets up to start throwing. The long man in the Toronto bullpen is marked there, 1-3. And you don't see too many fellas not having good seasons at Toronto, but Acker's mark is reflective of somebody having a lot of problems as Bobby Cox makes his way back to the dugout. 3-0, the Tigers on top. You saw three errors, but that's incorrect up on the board. It should read zero. In fact, these two teams have played the best defensive ball in the league. Toronto's only made 39 errors. Detroit's made 40 as the pitch is taken by Johnson for a strike.
You think that was a hit, Jim?
You're asking an ex-pitcher if he thinks it's a hit. It's obviously an error. No, it's a tough play, and the ball's sinking. And again, we don't really know how easy it or how difficult it is to see the ball off the bat here. I mean, Lewis,
he circled it. Yeah.
Leal obviously would like to have it be an error, but score is still 3-0, and he's got to make some good pitches here.
Well, that's what the manager cares about. The score is 3-0, but also I think the ball should have been caught.
Johnson, who had a home run last Monday and another yesterday, is up there with a count 1-2. The Blue Jay mascot. Crowd quiet right now in Toronto with the Tigers on top 3-0. And Johnson goes down for the second out here in the second inning. That's the first strikeout for Luis Leal. Two down in the second inning, and it brings up Lou Whitaker.
The second baseman, number one, Lou Whitaker.
You hear a few Lou's. Detroit not that far from Toronto. I suppose 200 air miles, maybe 240 on the highway. A strike, so a lot of Tiger fans here tonight.
Well, it seems like after they've gotten off to such a terrific start, there are a lot more Tiger fans all over the country.
Yep.
Many more Tiger hats than I've ever seen in airports.
Not just on Tom Selleck either. 1-1. Isn't that always the case, though? Whatever team gets off to the hot start, be it the Cardinals or the Brewers or whomever, some of those hats are showing up in Alaska, Guam.
Strike and the count, 1-2. It's like that commercial with you. Oh, that's great. That fella's waiting for the CFL season to get underway here. That's right, a 50-yard seat. That's the guy who's up there like you, Gillen. He missed the tag. You could be a long way away in this ballpark. Two balls and two strikes, the count on Whitaker.
This is an important man for Leal, and I think he knows it on the mound. There's a chance that if he loses him, especially to a base hit and another run scored, that he might be leaving the ballgame.
Two down. Jones is at second base. And the count is now 3-2 with Trammell waiting on deck. Luis Leal, undefeated this season, 2.75 earned run average, has been pitching very well. Beat Detroit in his last outing last Tuesday.
But that, of course, is one of the most difficult things to do, to come back against a good ball club and beat them back-to-back.
Giving up four hits to the first nine batters, and that one is just inside for ball four.
Well, he was being careful with the left-handed hitter, and rightly so. What do you think, Tim?
Well, when the next guy is leading the league in hitting, I'm not sure if it's a great idea, but you're taking a calculated gamble there, and you're just hoping you'll make some good pitches to Trammell here and get out of the inning.
He got him on the fist last time up, but it wound up being a three-base hit.
Alan Trammell hit a fly ball to center field that Mosby misplayed in the first inning. It was scored as a triple. Takes low for a ball, and the count is 1-0.
There's a pretty good pitch, and when you're in a four-game losing streak, it never seems like the umpire gives those to you.
Two on with two out. Breaking pitch, a beauty for a strike, 1-1. Jones is at second. There's Whitaker. Tigers leading 3-0 in the second inning. And Trammell looks at a strike of the knees, 1-2. Three great shortstops in the league. Ripken, Trammell, Yount. Ripken and Yount winning the last two MVP awards, and Trammell having that sort of a season right now. By the way, in the All-Star balloting released today, right now Ripken is the leader by a pretty wide margin, with Trammell second. That's for shortstop in the American League. Yount is third, and Alfredo Griffin, the Blue Jay shortstop, is fourth.
And no matter who's voted in, nobody's going to be wrong, because they're all deserving.
Kirk Gibson on deck. We're in the second inning. Tigers on top, 3-0. Leal's 1-2 pitch got him swinging, so he works out of further trouble and ends the second inning with a big strikeout. Two runs across for Detroit, middle of the second inning. It's the Tigers 3 and the Blue Jays 0.
Here at the Sharp Reliability Test Center for Televisions, we turn the temperature down to -4 degrees, and then we turn it up to 104 degrees. This one is about to go for a little ride to find out how tough he really is. And finally, the aging test to make sure they last and last. At Sharp, sure, we play rough with our TVs, but that's only so they play nice for you. From sharp minds come sharp products.
Suppose that's him?
Don't know who else would be out this early.
For the Caldwells, early morning's the best time to get things done. And times being what they are, not much would make them shut down, even for a few minutes. But this summer of 1984, the Caldwells have shut down to see something they'll most likely never see again. The games this summer, let's hope we all learn that the true measure of the Olympics is not in the winning, but discovering the best in all of us.
Budweiser Light, Golf's elite feel the pressure of a national championship but turn it into performance. Live exclusive 18-hole third and fourth round action at the U.S. Open. One of a kind. Beginning Thursday.
Tigers leading 3-0 as we go to the bottom of the second inning. Dave Rosma on the mound for Detroit. Full moon, beautiful day and a beautiful evening in Toronto, Ontario. Good crowd at Exhibition Stadium. Blue Jays, remember, always finished last until last season, and all of a sudden they got into the pennant race. They spent a good part of the season in first place, and in fact were in first place as late as August before fading at the end. Willie Upshaw looks at a strike. Upshaw to be followed by Akins and Bell. Willie having a fine season.
Well, he was the type of hitter when he first came up, was a left field singles hitter. Now last year, after hitting 27 home runs and getting off to a great start, he's the type of guy, if you throw the ball out over the plate, he can jerk it and hit it over that right field fence as quick as you can throw it.
Yeah, well, usually the reason for that is they're brought to the big leagues before their time.
Grounded down to second and kicked away by Whitaker. So a break for the Blue Jays as Upshaw gets aboard.
To me, a play like that, one that you don't see Whitaker make too often, is the fact that he's on artificial turf and he just relaxed. He's got the ball all the way. He's got it on the hop that he wants it. He knows he's got it, and bang, all of a sudden it's out of his glove. He kicks it with a foot, and that eliminates all chance of getting the man at first base. You can't relax in this game at any time.
Error charge to him. Willie Akins is the batter. Akins, who spent time in the offseason in prison, was suspended, as you know, along with Jerry Martin and Willie Wilson until the 16th of May. Chops it foul at the plate. And he's having a tough time getting on track as Bobby Cox uses him as the left-handed batting DH.
Well, with no spring training, it's certainly going to be tough to get started. And I talked to Willie before the ball game. He said he's just right now starting to feel decent at home plate. He's going to hit some home runs for him. There's no doubt about that.
He also is bothered by a leg muscle pull, and under the best of circumstances, Akins is not anywhere near fleet. So anything on the ground will probably be turned into a double play.
We're talking slow.
We're talking major slow.
Exactly.
Change up. Just missed somewhere.
Where was it, Jim?
A little bit high. As a pitcher, of course, you want that pitch.
As a pitcher, you should get that pitch.
One one to Akins in the air to left field. Jones is there, and Rupert handles it for the out as Upshaw retreats to first base. So one down here in the second inning, and it will bring up George Bell.
Looked to me like Rosema dropped down to a left-handed hitter right there. And I don't think that's such a good idea. Get to see it again in a good picture from the center field camera. Ah, he was over the top. The ball did break away from Akin. That was a curve ball. That wasn't the pitch that was flied out to left field.
That was the pitch that was called a ball.
He just ran like a fastball away from Akins. And when Rosema walked off the field last inning, he kept yelling to himself, get the ball down. And he has to keep the ball down in the strike zone to be successful.
Upshaw at first base with one out. Dave Rosema started the season in the rotation. He made three starts this year in April and went to the bullpen. He's made his last six appearances in relief. This is his first start since the 26th of April. Rosema, it seems like he's a lot older because he came up in 77, broke in with a flourish, but he's still only 27 years old.
He's been around a long time, and I think the one thing that Toronto is cognizant of is the fact that he has not pitched that much. And they're still in the ballgame, even though they're behind 3-0.
Little Scriver hit down to Trammell, who shovels to Whitaker and back on the first, not in time. The ball very slowly hit, and Bell has speed, so they settle for the force. And Bell is at first base with two down, and will bring up Rance Mullenix. Rance Mullenix platooned at third base with Garth Orge. was a successful combination last year. This year, Mullenix hitting 274.
Without any power, and if you kind of see that he has his right thumb bandaged. He dove for a ball and hyperextended his thumb, and he said he really has not felt that he can really pop the bat. Another thing, he batted second last year, and Earl will tell you, it's one of the major things in setting up your lineup is you probably get a lot more better pitches to hit hitting second, especially if your leadoff man is getting on, than you would hitting six or seven.
Well, I don't think there's any doubt about that, but with the power that Toronto has acquired, here's one of the guys that I'd want you to go right after. There's no doubt about that.
Mullenix does not have a home run this season. Last year, he had 10.
Well, he said that's a lot.
Go right after
him. A lot of fastballs.
With 10 home runs, go right after him, but keep him on the corner, Jim. Have you heard that before?
Exactly.
Little comebacker, speared by Rosma. And that'll do it here in the second inning. So the error by Whitaker does no damage, and we'll go to the third. The score remains Detroit 3 and Toronto nothing.
The elements will come to test your spray paint outside where metal needs great protection. When you choose an ordinary spray paint based on price, you pay the price. When you choose Rust-Oleum spray paint, you choose a paint that fights fading and rust longer than ordinary spray paint. When ordinary paints fail, Rust-Oleum won't. Rust-Oleum, supplier of paint products to the 1984 Olympics.
This is today's Chevrolet.
With the year-round versatility of S10 Blazer. In spring, Blazer's right on the job or on the town. In summer, Blazer lets you get to work or get away. In fall, Blazer's ready for the chores or for the fun. In winter, Blazer's a great outdoor sport. Chevy S10 Blazer. Every season, you'll find more reasons to own one. No wonder S10 Blazer's the best-selling sport utility vehicle in America.
Denerex versus Selsun Blue.
This side here, I've got a tingling sensation on my scalp. Feels good. On this side, there's not much any sensation. It's just kind of there.
Look what you used.
Denerex. Feels good. This is the side that was tingling.
Each shampoo has one medicine for dandruff. Only Denerex adds extra anti-itch medicine many dermatologists recommend.
The tingling felt like, hey, it's happening now. Selsun Blue's lost a customer. I'm a Denerex man.
Denerex shampoo or shampoo and conditioner fights dandruff and its itch.
Jim Lapley in New York. The Mets entered this evening just one game down to the Cubs in the National League East, and now they have a 1-0 lead on the Pirates. In the bottom of the second, Hubie Brooks hit this home run to give the Mets the lead behind 19-year-old pitching sensation Dwight Gooden. They're now in the top of the sixth, still leading 1-0. Another 19-year-old is on the mound for the Yankees in Fenway Park. But both the Yankees and Red Sox are fattening their batting averages. This home run for Rich Gettman in the bottom of the fourth off Jose Rijo has cut what was once a three-run Yankee lead back to 4-3. Now let's go back to Al Michaels in Toronto.
All right, Jim, and here as we go to the third inning, Detroit on top 3-0, on top in the East by 7 games. Baltimore 11 back after they were swept by Detroit yesterday. Beginning to lead off against Leal in the third and looks at a strike. Gibson hit a sacrifice fly in the first inning. Batting 283. 1-1. Big day for Gibson yesterday as the Tigers won 10-4 and 8-0. Gibson had 6 hits, 3 in each game. 1-2 to count.
Stars in the game. Speed, power. Could you get him out easy, Jim?
He's one of the few guys I got out on their team last year, as a matter of fact.
Down he goes. 3 strikeouts, no score. Baltimore-Milwaukee second inning. Oakland leads Texas in the first. 2-0. Other games underway in the American League, where the schedule tonight is abbreviated. already updated you on the Yankee Red Sox doings. Parrish is the batter. Lance takes in shot for a ball. 1-0. Parrish flied out in the first inning. Drill to left field and into the corner, and that's a fair ball bouncing up against the fence. Parrish rounds first on his way to second and is in there with a double. That's five hits now, and four of them for extra bases off Leal.
And here you see, like most power hitters, you get the ball in the middle of the plate, they get their arms extended, and they hit the ball pretty crisply. And that ball was massaged into left field.
He'd have got under that just a little bit, it would have been gone.
You really have to get him out consistently, you have to throw your breaking ball away, and as you said, throw your fastball up and in, and that's real tough for a pitcher to do all the time.
Yeah. Up. High and tight, low and away, that'll get anybody in baseball out.
Evans takes inside, ball one. National League scores. Tim Wallach's homer in the ninth, the difference. Montreal beat Chicago. Cardinals lead the Phillies 5-3. Phillies started the day a game back, and with the Cubs already having lost, a victory for the Phillies would move them into a tie with Chicago for first in the East. 1-1. Other scores. The Giants lead the Dodgers 2-0 in the third inning. San Diego off early, leading Atlanta 3-0 in the second. Padres were a game and a half in front, beginning play today. Cincinnati has the lead in the second inning at Houston. And that's Mario Soto seeking his eighth for the Reds. Fly ball off the bat of Evans to shallow center field. Mosby got a late start, but comes sprinting in to make the catch. And there are two down here in the third inning.
Detroit has three runs, but I think Leal's got good stuff.
Well, he made a good pitch there. He got it up and in. Darrell Evans is a good low ball hitter. And I asked Buck Martinez, what's the difference between Leal this year and last year? Last year he's 13-12. This year he's 6-0. He says, we got to walk out there and tell him, let's go. Let's throw the ball. Tonight, hasn't got a whole lot of breaks, but he is, as you said, Earl, throwing the ball well. He has a good curveball. And his outfield, which usually plays pretty well. I mean, they have some outstanding outfielders with the exception of maybe Dave Collins. They're all above average outfielders, have just not made the plays.
Exactly. You can make a case for Leal not having a lot of run in the first inning. Trammell's triple is a catchable ball that Mosby didn't see until it was too late. Evans then got that base hit off Upshaw's glove in the second inning. Grubb's double was solid, but then Jones's double was a catchable ball. Been right.
And again, once you get behind in a game, every batter, especially with a runner in scoring position like this, is very key. There you see that curveball. Grubb reminds me a lot of a hitter other kind of like Kenny Singleton, where he doesn't hit with as much power, but when he does hit ground balls, they seem not to go at any of the infielders. He can get jammed and just hit it up the middle, and there's nobody playing there. But as we said before, if you pitch him away, he will go to left field.
Keeps it in on him and inside. Two balls and one strike, the count on John Grubb.
There's somebody in the league he doesn't hit, though, because he's only hitting 273.
The knock against Johnny Grubb was that he was always injury prone, never really could play a lot.
Swing and a miss in the count 2-2. Grubb's always been a good hitter when he first came up with San Diego. You knew he could swing the bat. He's hit 300 twice during his career.
With Palmer in the booth, though, he won't hit as much as this year as he did in past years.
I found the one effective pitch. He never really knew that I would throw many sliders to left-handers, and I all of a sudden threw him a slider, kind of like what I did to Nettles, and it gave him another pitch to look for.
Up high. Proud of you, Earl. It only took you 2.5 innings to get in your first overt dig.
Nettles hit him pretty good, too.
You want to name about 15 others now while we have the time?
Man wins 268 games. He got somebody out.
How many did he lose, though?
It wasn't Nettles, I'll tell you that.
3-2 pitch is inside, gets away from Witt, and with Grubb going to first base, Parrish goes to third, putting runners at first and third as Chet Lemon comes to the plate.
And here you just see trying to get him out with a curveball, with a runner on second. He really doesn't matter if he bounced it, just wants to get on top of it, and he did, but it was in the dirt and went by Witt for a pass ball, or I guess actually a wild pitch.
I thought it was a good selection. 3-2 breaking ball with a man on second base.
Well, you have a tendency when you're down three runs to gamble, and what happens, it's great if you get Chet Lemon out, but put that extra runner on base, sometimes it backfires and you can really find yourself out of the ballgame. Yeah.
Now last week I said that when I was managing Baltimore, we hated to throw this guy Lemon a slider with men on base, and yet the Toronto pitching staff kept throwing them sliders and had success.
There's another one.
Lemon, it's a fly ball to right center field, and again it's Mosby racing into his bell, and it's Bell making the catch, and the outfielders are having great difficulty picking up fly balls tonight. At the end of 2.5, it's the Tigers 3 and the Blue Jays nothing.
How can a guy 5'9 have an unfair advantage over these guys? I use the Gillette Atra razor. They don't. It's got the advantage of a pivoting head. Atra is better than twin blade razors that don't pivot. See? They don't always stay in my beard, but my Atra pivots to keep both blades on my beard longer. So I get a better shave. Close. Comfortable.
Get the Gillette Atra and get the Atra advantage.
Sometimes a little advantage goes a long way.
You work hard. Working hard against the clock could mean perspiration odor. Gillette's Right Guard stick is so potent, one application destroys odor-causing bacteria on contact and for up to 24 hours.
From Anheuser-Busch, here's L.A. Great taste and half the alcohol of our regular beers.
You've shaped this world and changed it, made it better, rearranged it, in the way you think and what you drink and everything you do.
L.A. for smooth taste and drinkability and only half the alcohol of our regular beers.
For the way you live your life today.
For the way.
Get the whole story with Howard Cosell on the only regularly scheduled sports journalism series on network television. A candid look at the issues and figures behind the headlines. The Emmy Award-winning ABC Sports Beat.
Quite a sight. Prototypical Canadian sunset in Toronto. As you look around Exhibition Stadium, they don't sell very many of those seats out yonder there behind center and right center in this stadium. As you can tell, that was constructed basically for football, turned into a multi-purpose facility when the Blue Jays were granted their expansion franchise in 1977. And the talk here now is about a new stadium, perhaps by 1987. And we're talking about, among other things, among other plans, a retractable dome. Ernie Witt to lead off in the bottom of the third inning. Witt, Griffin, and Garcia. 3-0 Detroit.
It's way too early to think about a reliever, but I'm sure Sparky Anderson has got in his mind.
That's a base hit into right field, and that's the first hit off Dave Rosewood.
Getting back to Sparky Anderson, he might have in his mind a number of pitches that he wants Dave Rosewood to throw tonight. Or he might have talked to Rosema before the game, and Rosema might have told him, let me go as long as I possibly can.
I talked to Rosema in the clubhouse before the game, and he knows what his job is. He said, I'm going to go out there for 5 or 6, and I know that Sparky's got who he needs in the pen, namely Lopez and Hernandez.
Well, the bullpen has 19 saves and 11 wins, so I think Sparky will go quick.
Of course, Petrie helped him out pitching that complete game 3 hitter in the second game of the doubleheader yesterday.
Alfredo Griffin, switch hitter. Number 9 hitter.
He's hitting higher at 255 than he normally does. What's interesting, he's only walked 3 times, 188 times at bat. And I think one of the interesting things Bobby Cox has done is move him from a leadoff position to batting 9. Not the ideal leadoff man.
Not if you're only going to walk 3 times and that number of bats.
Rosema's always had a lot of success against Toronto because think it's analogous to something that Jack Morris said, who happens to be 11-2 and probably the top pitcher with the Tigers, is that he likes to pitch against Toronto because they're more aggressive. Rosema is a breaking ball pitcher. Basically, Toronto are all fastball hitters. In fact, at least they hit the fastball a little bit better. Rosema throws a lot of junk. If he can get his breaking ball over, which he just did to Griffin, he's going to be very effective.
Popped up, back of second, and Alan Trammell goes out into shallow center to haul it in off the bat of Griffin as Witt remains at first base. And with one away, it'll bring up Damaso Garcia.
Second baseman, number 7, Damaso Garcia.
Garcia hitting 308, popped out in the first inning. Had a great year last year, hit 307, hit 310 the year before. So he's establishing himself as a man who is right up around that 300 mark with consistency now.
And again, a guy that does not want to walk. Rosema pitched him high and inside. He jammed himself the first time. It'll be interesting to see how he tries to get him out this time.
Broken bat, Swimmer back of second by Trammell for a base hit, and Witt will stop at second base.
And again, a case of a pretty good pitch.
Well, again, he went up and in. Garcia, I've always had the feeling when I pitch against him, when I wind up, he starts swinging. And here you'll see the fastball which Rosema throws. It runs in, hits it right off the label of the bat. Trammell can't quite get to it.
At 77 hits now for Garcia this season, only Trammell has more with 80. If you project it out, he's on a pace that would hit him about 200 hits over the course of the year.
One thing I've never figured out in baseball with a hitter like Garcia is, if he were more selective, if he looked for a few more base on balls, would he hit as much? Would he hit more? Or would he hit less? And certainly the on-base percentage would have to go up if he gets a few more walks, which helps your ballplay.
Collins with two on and one out takes a strike on the inside corner. 3-0 Detroit, with the Jays threatening in the bottom of the third inning. No balls, two strikes now. Ernie Witt at second. Damaso Garcia at first. Big game for the Blue Jays, who last week, after they had won on Wednesday, had cut Detroit's lead to 3.5. But all of a sudden, it's back to 7 now.
Well, they went into New York after winning really 19-22 one-run ball games, lost the first two games by one run, and then yesterday by two. They realize, we said in the pregame show, they're just not getting the clutch hit. And here's a perfect chance for Collins to make amends.
One ball, two strikes, the count on Dave Collins, former Mariner, former Red, former Yankee. Witt and Garcia, the base runners. And the 1-2 to Collins is in high.
Breaking ball in the middle of the plate. Collins, not known for his power, gets all of it.
Well, it's probably one of the few pitches that Dave Collins can hit out of the ballpark. He only has one home run up to this point of the season, but that was laid right there for him to hit it out. And I hate to even mention it, but there's the three-run homer in the scores tag.
Collins' other homer came against the Twins as Upshaw hits a grounder down to Whitaker, and that's that here in the third inning. But the Blue Jays get even on a homer by Collins. Three runs, three hits, and nobody left on. Brand new ball game as we go to the fourth. It's Detroit 3 and Toronto 3.
Give me a light. Bud Light.
If you just ask for a light beer, you never know what you'll get.
Give me a light. Bud Light.
So if you want the less filling light beer with the first name and taste, don't just ask for a light beer.
Hey, give me a light.
Ask them to bring out their best.
No, Bud Light.
Bud Light. Because everything else is just a light.
It's a wild place.
Play ball.
You've got such style, such flair. Do you really believe you've got a prayer?
You'll catch it all on Kodak Color VR400, one of Kodak's fastest color print films ever. You can't miss, almost.
Oh, you're having so much fun, but you never scored a run. That's why the other guys just won.
Kodak, because time goes by.
This is today's Chevrolet.
Z28.
Camaro Z28. A Camaro that did a test track 0 to 55 in 6 seconds. A Camaro with remarkable new handling.
Z28.
Camaro. More beauty and a lot more beast. Performance. That's today's Chevrolet.
And we're back in Toronto where this ABC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by the best has a taste all its own. Satisfying, but never filling. Dave Collins, a home run, his second of the season. He hit only one all of last year. Not a man with a great deal of power, but he hits one out at a most propitious time for the Blue Jays as it gets them even. And on to the fourth inning we go with Rupert Jones to lead off by grounding one to the right side. Upshaw is there to glove it over to Leon, covering one away.
Pretty good play by Upshaw getting over there. Come up with the right hop. He had time to give it to him underhanded, and he threw the ball hard overhanded and almost threw it into the dugout. Nice play by Leal.
So one down here in the fourth inning. And the number 9 hitter, switch hitter, Howard Johnson. Change up for a strike, 1-1.
We were joking early about how Sparky really likes to bump up his players when Howard Johnson came up 2 years ago. Of course, Sparky said, here's a guy that's going to play third base for me. And you see him hit a base hit to right field. And hit 300 for the rest, for at least 10 years. Of course, next year he was in the minors, but he certainly is hitting well this year.
And Sparky honestly believes that, and he told me before the ball game that he's going to play Johnson against some left-handers pretty soon.
What he does is he uses Johnson in there to start a game and get him 2 or 3 at-bats, and then optimally they have the lead, and he'll go with Tommy Brookins defensively at the end of the game to protect it. So Johnson is at first base with one away, and the batter is Whitaker. Fly to left and walk. Time had been called before the throw to first base. There was something going on.
There's a television camera with a light on shining right in the first baseman and first ump our space, and it's not ours. It's a local camera. Handheld camera.
Yeah, there's
they won't turn the light on.
Realize that that's the problem is what it amounts to. Now the fella gets the idea.
A little embarrassed.
That'll make for a good clip on his news tonight. Throw to first base, driving Johnson back. Whitaker batting 314.
Johnson only has three steals at first base. Stole necessarily an order, but the hit and run possible.
That's to deep right field, and that one is out into the night. So Whitaker hits his fifth home run of the season. And Al now has given up a total of seven hits, five of them for extra bases. And Detroit is back up on top 5-3. Well, we had a little home run derby action last week in Tiger Stadium, duplicating that tonight.
Both clubs are up top in home runs.
There you saw a fastball down the middle. This was the, I guess, the easiest park to hit home runs in the major league last year, 185. You're seeing why. Ball does carry well, but Leal did not make a very good pitch.
That prompts activity in the bullpen again as Trammell fouls off the first pitch, 0-1. Trammell with a gift triple. Mosby couldn't find it when it left the bat in the first inning, and then he struck out in the second. And again, it's Acker throwing in the Toronto pen.
One of the most important things a pitcher can do when he's trailing in a ball game and his team comes back to tie the score, he wants to go out there and shut the door so they can kind of keep that momentum they've gained. And of course, Leal was unable to do that.
Fight to get even, and then all of a sudden you're trailing again.
Exactly. But Whitaker hit 319 last year, can hit 12 home runs, can hit the ball out of the ballpark, but also walks. So you kind of have quite a dilemma if you're a pitcher. He doesn't swing at too many bad pitches. He makes you throw the ball over the plate. And then when you, especially in a ballpark like here or Detroit, where it's not too difficult to hit home runs, he can do that.
When you wait for those strikes and you hit the ball like that, that's why you're fourth or fifth in the league in hitting.
2-2, the one out, base is empty. Fourth inning, 5-3, Detroit. And called 3. Nice pitch. Fastball. Blowing away.
And here you see Leal just making an excellent pitch. He struck him out on a breaking ball the time before. Ball is right on the corner.
92 mile an hour fastball, and if he put him up there all night, they wouldn't have five runs on the scoreboard.
Gibson the batter. 1-0 the count. Sacrifice fly struck out. 0-1. Gibson batting 281. Rip right in upshot. In the fourth inning, the homer by Whitaker puts the Tigers back out in front as you look at Lou, and at the end of 3.5, 5-3, Tigers.
My daughter calls it the Blue Bomber. My wife thinks I ought to get rid of it. And when it needed a new muffler, well, I was afraid she might be right.
Listen, I don't want to spend too much on this car.
Midas had a muffler that was perfect for my budget. Now the old Blue Bomber sounds almost as good as new. And heck, she doesn't look that bad.
Trust the Midas touch.
Burger King presents the dawn of burgers. In the beginning, it was hard to get a hamburger at all. So when you got one, you made the most of it by cooking over fire. Today, some have forsaken flame and turned to the practice of frying, forgetting the sizzling taste that only comes from flame broiling. But at Burger King, we say, when you've got something as delicious as flame broiling, you stay with it for a long, long time.
Make every document the same size.
Charts in color.
Figures in blue.
Headings in black.
And collate it.
Right.
This job is for a multiple-choice copier, the Canon NP-155. Its zoom system makes a full range of enlargements and reductions, up to 15 copies a minute in black, brown, or blue, and can collate.
Done.
Do I know how to pick a value?
Yes.
Yes.
Canon's NP-155 gives you more for less. For information, call toll-free.
Jim Lapley again in New York. You're going to look at a Keith Hernandez home run, which has stretched the Mets' lead over the Pirates to 3-0. This came in the bottom of the sixth. They're now going to the bottom of the seventh, and Dwight Gooden struck out the side in the top of the seventh, needs two more to pass Valenzuela for the league lead. Back to Al Michaels.
All right, that's what's happening at Shea and here in Toronto. We talked about the possibility of a dome up here, and that's one man's opinion. It won't win any grammatical honors, but you do get the point.
Well, a retractable dome is the ideal situation.
Absolutely.
I think today's fans want to plan on going to a ball game some 2-3 weeks ahead of time, and if you got a dome, you know that there's going to be a game that night.
Willie Akins is the batter, takes up. I agree, the retractable dome is the answer. As you look at other scores, Yankees leading 4-3 in the sixth, Orioles have the lead in the third, A's have the lead at Arlington in the third. But nobody's built a retractable dome yet, at least not on the major league level. As it's hit in the air to left field and into the corner goes Jones to make the play. Rupert, who has a lot of experience playing center, has no trouble with that one in left. One away here in the fourth inning, and George Bell comes up. 0 for 1 tonight.
Here's a fellow who was here before his time, Jim. You remember?
Exactly. I talked to some of the Toronto players. They've said he's been hitting since spring training, and he's still hitting.
Third in the league in hitting at 338. I think what you meant, Earl, is that he came up. He came up in 1981. Was here the whole season, not quite ready. Back down he went for a year and a half, and then they brought him up in this season last year. Final score: Montreal over the Cubs at Wrigley today, 2-1. And in the sixth inning, the Cardinals leading Philadelphia 6-3. Giants leading in the third. Padres leading in the fourth. Reds back of Soto on top in the third. One ball, one strike to count. Bell is one of four Blue Jays from the Dominican Republic. You might know that the Dominican Republic has been added to the Olympic baseball tournament, baseball a demonstration sport in L.A., and the Dominican team was having some trouble getting the funds to come to L.A., and the Blue Jay organization made a $10,000 contribution to help defray those expenses to send that team to Los Angeles in July. So a great feeling for the folks from the Dominican as far as this organization is concerned, with 16% of its roster coming from one country.
Exactly. When I was out in Los Angeles last week, Manny Mota and Pedro Guerrero were trying to raise funds also, being Dominican players.
And that team will be there.
And they'll send a good team, too.
George Bell looks like he's very slight. Buck Martinez says, if you take off his shirt, looks like he was sculpted with a pallet. It's just...
He just got sculpted by Rosma right there, and down he goes.
Pitch high out to strike zone.
That was a backup breaking ball, the one you think is going to break, but doesn't. It just kind of hangs inside. And here you see Rosenberg throwing a what's supposed to be a breaking ball, but it's just spinning, and Bell's kind of swinging where it's supposed to go, but it just stays inside. And one of the tougher pitches for hitters to hit. They just think it's going to break, and it doesn't.
Mullenix is the batter. Can a pitcher literally throw a backup breaking ball or a backup slider, or does it just happen?
Well, some pitchers can do it. I think a lot of pitchers are coming up with a breaking ball that they call a backdoor breaking ball.
Here's a fly ball to right field. And I'll get you to amplify when we come back in the fifth inning as the Blue Jays go out in order. We'll go to the fifth. The score is Detroit 5, Toronto 3.
This is today's Chevrolet. Chevrolet Caprice Classic, one of the world's great automotive values. And for 13 years in a row, the full-size Chevrolet has been the best-selling car of its kind. It's easy to see why. Compare Caprice's deep cushion comfort, its ride, its full-size room, and its affordable price. You can, of course, spend more for a car. But why in the world would you? Quality. That's today's Chevrolet.
This is one of the few computers that has not benefited from AT&T computer technology. Over the years, AT&T innovations have helped other companies' computers become smarter, faster, and easier to use. This is AT&T's newest innovation, AT&T Computers. Business computers specially designed to let people communicate more easily, more reliably. They may just change the way you think about computers.
Here you go, Tommy. You know, this new L8 Anheuser-Busch is quite a beer. Naturally aged, smooth. It tastes great. Real, drinkability.
See, the way I figured it, with only half the alcohol of the regular beers.
There'd be certain times when L.A. beer would be a really good idea. Boy, was I wrong.
Around at L.A., Jim.
These guys think it's a good idea anytime.
For the way you live, L.A.
It's a whole new brand of beer enjoyment.
Golf's elite feel the pressure of a national championship, but turn it into performance. Live exclusive 18-hole third and fourth round action at the U.S. Open. One of a kind. Beginning Thursday.
Going to the fifth inning on a beautiful night in Toronto. Al Michaels with Jim Palmer and Earl Weaver. 5-3, Detroit on top. The Blue Jay mascot right there. Jim, we were discussing in the fourth inning, baseball fans have heard the term backup slider, backup breaking ball, whether or not a pitcher can actually control that pitch or whether or not it just happens on the way to the plate. And you were amplifying in terms of
well, of course,
the response.
I think Dave Roseman striking out George Bell, it just happened, but there are a lot of pitchers that try to throw that curveball a little bit outside and have to bring it over the outside corner of the plate. One of the best curveballs, and a guy that really doesn't matter if he throws it inside or outside, is Tiffy Martinez of the Orioles. He gets on top of his curveball. I think any pitcher that gets on top of it and the spin is down and he's on top of the ball, it's going to be a good breaking ball.
On top is the secret. Tippy's break straight down. The old drop when I started baseball that Howard Cosell talked about last week.
Parrish is the batter. 1-0 the count. Luis Leal had a struggle through four innings, giving up seven hits. Some of those tainted, though.
Well, my feeling is he's still throwing good. He's put some pitches in bad spots. If his location gets better, I think his stuff's good enough to get him out.
I think the standpoint of, from a manager, Earl, is Jim Acker was warming up, who's 1-3, and here you have a guy that's 6-0. Do you want to get beat with Leal if you think he can do a job? And as you said, there have been some misplays that have kind of created maybe three out of the five runs. What would you do?
Well, those are the decisions why a lot of us got fired. We did the wrong things too many times.
But you never got fired.
I never got fired.
Two and two the count.
And these two managers aren't doing too many things wrong either with the percentage that both clubs are playing, winning percentage.
Well, these managers have been fired despite their recent success. Bobby Cox let go when he was at Atlanta. And then Sparky Anderson shockingly fired after the 1978 season. After 9 years at Cincinnati. Can't swing, fooled him. Strike three. A look at 50-year-old George Anderson of Thousand Oaks, California. It's the way he views himself. As two men. Good old George Anderson, the ordinary man, and Sparky of the field.
Well, he's made a lot of right decisions in his time. You know, that's not only the punt, the hit and run, the steal, when to put it on, but who to have on your ball club and help your general manager as to what you're after the following year, what you need to win.
Well, Sparky told his front office people they needed somebody like a Darrell Evans to fill out some holes that Detroit had last year. They went out and got Darrell Evans. 2-0 to count. 2-1 now.
Probably had a lot to say about Rupert Jones also.
Sure. Fond memories for Sparky coming back into this city. He played here as a minor leaguer for 4 years, and then he actually started his managerial career with the old Toronto Club in the International League in 64.
Leal's throwing good now. Pitch he got Parrish on was a good breaking ball on the outside half the plate. Good fastball there up and out of the strike zone, and it's just been a little bit of lack of control and location.
2-2 pitch. And he fooled him. So he has fooled both Parrish and Evans here, and he has six strikeouts, does Leal, with two down now in the fifth inning. And Johnny Grubb coming up.
Well, a sign of a good pitcher is when your fastball is getting hit. Number one, to realize it. Number two, be able to do something about it. And Parrish's double, and really just missed a home run on a fly ball to left field. He came back with a breaking ball and got him out. Almost all the hits tonight have been on fastballs, and now he's going to his breaking ball more.
5-3 Detroit. 1-0 the count on Grubb.
There was a good spot to throw the fastball. In other words, you're saying try to keep it out of the strike zone and get him with the breaking ball.
Well, I don't know too many pitchers that can really pitch within the strike zone. I think guys that are other than maybe Nolan Ryan and Koufax and even Valenzuela, as good as he is, what you want to do is get him to hit balls and swing at balls.
Grubb grounds to second. Garcia throws him out. And Leal has his first 1-2-3 inning, and he has set down five straight. In the middle of the fifth inning, it remains Tigers 5, Blue Jays 3.
There, that was the hot spot where the fire started. The Felixes lost their whole house, but now they're getting it all back again. From the shake shingles to the oak cabinets to the wallpaper in the baby's bedroom, State Farm will pay to replace it all because the Felixes bought State Farm guaranteed replacement cost coverage, so everything's going to be the way it was.
And like a good neighbor,
even if it costs more than anyone thought it would,
State Farm is there.
Sharp introduces its computer to go, the PC-5000.
That Sharp may have a printer, but it can't possibly have 128K power like my desktop IBM.
Sure, and it expands to 256.
That Sharp can't possibly do word processing and communication and spreadsheets like my desktop IBM.
Sure,
with bubble memory program.
Well, what doesn't it do?
It doesn't stay glued to a desktop.
Like my IBM.
Sharp's affordable, portable computer to go, the PC-5000. From Sharp Minds come Sharp products.
I'm Mr. Goodwrench. You know what starts when your engine starts? Engine wear.
50 strokes, 100 strokes, 200 piston strokes of wear per second. Only a fine lubricant can protect it. Introducing new GM Goodwrench Motor Oil. The motor oil from General Motors that meets or exceeds all GM specifications.
Great protection from me, Mr. Goodwrench.
To keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM parts.
Ernie Witt will lead off for the Jays in the bottom of the fifth inning. Last week, Howard Cosell in Detroit asked Sparky Anderson after the Tigers' great start if he thought the pennant race would be close.
It's going to be a pennant race. You got the Baltimore Orioles, who are the world champions, and I don't know how you disappear world champions so fast. I didn't know you did it in April and May. And they're going to be in the hunt all the way, and they're going to be the club. I think when it comes down to a showdown, Toronto and us are going to have to be able to beat Baltimore. I think Toronto's an excellent club. I think they'll prove it all year. I think we're a very good team. I think it's going to be a three-team race, and I'm not trying to duck the issue. I believe you're going to have to beat the Baltimore Orioles.
He's trying to duck the issue a little bit.
Well, of course he is. But
they did.
Like any manager would, right?
Yeah, I mean, like any manager would.
You were asked a zillion questions day in, day out in June of every year.
It's tough enough to beat somebody without getting them all over your back also.
Sure.
We never had a lead in June, though. That was the problem.
That's true.
69 and 70.
That's right. That's when it was easy, right? 109, 108 wins.
Right.
Well, and it got difficult. Only won 101 the next year.
Now the belly's just trying to do it the way Weaver did it. Dig yourself a hole early and come out of it. Witt hits one down the line and right, just foul. Foul. 1-1 the count on Witt, to be followed by Griffin and Garcia, with Detroit leading 5-3 in the bottom of the fifth inning.
Well, Leal bounced back last inning, 1-2-3. Rosen is the fellow I'd be a little concerned about right about now in this ballgame.
Bobby Cox looking on. Another look here at how close that ball came to being a fair ball.
That's what I call a good pitch. One that's a foot foul.
Two homers in the game. Collins, a three-run homer for Toronto. Difference right now is Whitaker's two-run homer in the fourth inning for the Tigers. As Witt hits it sharply by Evans and down into the right field corner. Fair ball. Witt is on his way into second, and Ernie leads off the bottom of the fifth with a stand-up double.
Here we see a changeup on the inside half of the plate. You just throw defense hitters over the first base bag, and the ball goes by for a double. You see Evans going to his left. The thing that most people don't realize, the ball really picks up speed on AstroTurf. Second and third bounce can be much quicker.
Ernie Witt, two hits tonight. He has half the Blue Jay total, and Griffin is the batter. He popped out in the third inning. Batting 254, he fouls it away. 0-1 the count.
Griffin should be thinking of trying to pull a ball in the first two pitches, trying to get that runner from second base over to third. Another thing that he could do with the speed he had is bunt for a base hit in this situation. Not necessarily a sacrifice, but try to beat one out, because you'll get the runner over to third, and it would be scored as a sacrifice anyway.
And that's exactly what he's going to do, but it's a foul ball. It's the right idea, and he went the only way he could, because Johnson was playing in shallow at third.
Bobby Cox might even have a sign for a bunt for a base hit, because a lot of ball players don't know that it's an offensive weapon in a situation like that, and you can flash the sign, do a little thinking for your ball player sometime.
Nice call, Earl.
Another important part of bunting is also you bring the infield in. Lou Whitaker was not playing particularly shallow. You go up there and bunt on the first pitch, he comes in a couple of steps and it enhances the chance of you hitting the ball by him. Hitters just don't realize that sometimes.
Right now, his job is to try to get the bat on the ball any way he can. If he gets him over, fine. If he don't, there's not much else you can do about it.
0-2 the count. Witt at second base and nobody out. And he strikes him out. Took something off it, and down goes Griffin, and that's strikeout number two for Dave Rosma. So one down, and the top of the order now, Damaso Garcia.
Again, we'll see how Rosema works. Garcia pitched him inside twice, jammed him both times. Once was an out, once was a base hit, looped into center field.
Inside, one ball, no strikes.
One time, if I remember right, we tried to throw high fastballs to this fella and get him to hit fly balls to the outfield. He's driving the ball a little bit better now than he did then.
Came around, and it's a strike. 1-1. Halftime score, San Antonio leading the Pittsburgh Maulers 14-3 in USFL action tonight.
Really a high breaking ball, but the break of the ball fools Garcia. Pretty good pitch to hit.
Count stays 1-2 on Garcia.
Swung at two bad breaking balls and took the breaking ball down the center for a strike.
In the bullpen is the newest Tiger, Sid Mangi, just picked up with San Diego, and his stats with the Padres reflected there. To make room, Glenn Abbott is now off the 25-man roster. He was yesterday's starting pitcher in game one in Baltimore. So the Tigers have gone through the whole season without a roster change. Have just made three in the past week. And that one hits Garcia. So after he gets ahead on the count, he comes back to hit him with a pitch.
No intent to hit Garcia in that situation whatsoever. It was a high breaking ball that slid out of Rosema's hands. See the pitch again right here. I think it was supposed to be a curveball that just stayed right in, didn't do a thing. Garcia had nothing to do but turn his back to him. Curveball doesn't have as much velocity on the fastball and probably won't bother Garcia at all.
It's one of your backup breaking balls, huh?
But you know you don't want to hit him, because this brings the winning run to the plate. Tying run at first with good speed and the winning run at the plate.
And the crowd responds as Dave Commons with the home run in the third inning comes up again with two men on. And Commons has been very proficient with men in scoring position this season, batting 429. with men in scoring position. 15-35.
That's one of the reasons he's been able to keep Jesse Barfield out of the lineup against a lot of right-handed pitching.
Collins hits it high in the air to left center field, but Lemon races back and makes the catch, and the runners hold. Collins trying to muscle up again, but he's hit the ball well three times tonight.
That he has, but Roseman made a good pitch. He hung a curveball the second time up and hit a three-run home run. That time he went with his fastball. Even if he does single, tough to score from second with Ernie Wheat with speed. Not a bad pitch.
Lloyd Mosby fly to right, fly to left. Tigers on top, 5-3 in the bottom of the fifth inning with Witt at second and Garcia at first.
And Roseman's got to be careful here.
Toward the gap in left center field, and it's Jones, though, racing over to make the catch. So Collins and Mosby hit it hard, but the outfielders chase him down, and the Jays squander a threat in the fifth. Still 5-3 Detroit as we go to the sixth, and we'll return to Toronto after this word from our local stations. Sixth inning at Toronto. Oh, yeah, that looks pretty good. Exhibition Stadium on a very pleasant night.
Not a Dodger dog, but it'll do.
Yep, we had one of those for lunch today.
What's
Michaels, Palmer,
dog?
And that's a Dodger Stadium hot dog. Generally regarded as the best west of the Mississippi.
Now, if you're real old, you would, what do we call a Coliseum hot dog?
Like Weaver, right?
Well, no.
Ebbets Field hot dog. Ebbets Field hot dog.
Well,
Sportsman's Park hot dog.
They St. Louis.
They used to be a dime then when it was Sportsman's Park in St. Louis.
Don't date yourself.
I'm proud of you guys, though, tonight. Palmer insisted on sitting next to Weaver through the course of this one. Don Chevrier, who does some of the Blue Jay games and does a lot of our boxing on ABC, is in the booth to serve as the Arthur Mercanti in case you guys get a little feisty. Number 34. You'll be picking Earl up at the airport next week, I assume.
Oh, no doubt.
Chet Lemon in the sixth inning. Takes outside, ball one. 1-0. Well.
That a boy, Jim. That a boy.
Grounded down to short. And Griffin throws it out, so there's one away here in the sixth inning. Next Monday night, well, the Tigers will be featured again for some of you. Detroit against the Yankees from Tiger Stadium, or the Texas Rangers taking on the California Angels on week three of Monday Night Baseball.
Baylor, Kemp, and Winfield starting to get hot. So when they do, you know they're going to win some games.
They want to keep Berra in there, don't they?
They sure do.
By the way, some of the speculation in Toronto this week was that the Blue Jays ran into the Yankee buzzsaw because the Yankees were threatened with the reemergence of Billy Martin as the manager, and they wanted to keep Berra there.
Well, I like the way Don Baylor said. He said, some of us are going to one out if Martin comes back. Not some players, but some of us. Oh, that's funny.
1-1. So things will be interesting, no doubt, as they always are when the Yankees come in. Next Monday. Ground into the hole, and that's a base hit for Rupert Jones. His second of the game. And the batter will be Howard Johnson. And no doubt, of course, with Weaver there, when the Yankees are in town, the rumors will start that you're going to take over again, Earl.
It's possible.
What's possible that the rumors are going to take over or that you may take over?
No, just rumors.
Oh, just rumors.
I just want to know one thing. When you take over the Yankees, are you bringing Palmer back with you?
Definitely.
Okay. David Palmer? Which Palmer?
Jim, Arnold. Not David. David's got his future ahead of him. Jim Palmer's going to get his 32 some way or another.
I've heard that line before. Howard Johnson struck out and singled. 10 for his last 17. Very hot hitter at the plate right now.
And on that base hit to Rupert, Leal got that changeup in another bad spot again. It's right down the middle, belt high.
0-1 the count.
Kind of compare Rupert Jones. Really gives Sparky a lot of latitude late in ball games. Put him in there for defense if he hasn't started the game, because he is an outstanding defensive player. Similar to what Joe Altobelli could do in Baltimore last year with Tito Landrum.
Yes.
Here's a guy that's a natural center fielder, but can play right field and left field, has a good throwing arm.
Quite an addition. He can steal a base, too.
0-1 pitch. Slap foul, and the count on Johnson is nothing and two. Five runs, eight hits, one error for the Tigers. Three runs, four hits, and no errors for the Blue Jays. Detroit seven games in front at the start of play tonight.
However, with the left-handed, getting back to stolen base, left-handed hitter up, first baseman Upshaw has to hold a runner on it, gives Johnson the hole to hit to in the right field.
One ball, two strikes.
Sparky not a big advocate of the stolen base. He's got some guys on his club that he lets go. But I think he would let Rupert go if there were two outs. We'll see what happens.
Teams have had pretty good success running against the Jays this season. But Johnson goes down as Jones remains at first. And that's strikeout number seven for Leal, the second time he has taken care of Johnson in that fashion. And it brings up Whitaker, whose home run in the fourth inning is the difference in the game.
And now I think we can look for Jones to give it a try. If he's thrown out, you still got a 315 hitter in Lou Whitaker with some speed leading off the next inning. Leal spotting that fastball pretty good right now.
Whitaker is leading in the balloting right now for second base in the All-Star game with Garcia second. Pretty good size lead for him too. Pitch out. Jones not going. 1-1. Have some fellas in the roles of starters right now in terms of the balloting for the All-Star game. Lance Parrish leading amongst the catchers. Whitaker at second. Trammell is second at shortstop, as we stated before. Chet Lemon has the third most votes in the outfield behind Reggie Jackson and Dave Winfield. So as of the moment, he would be starting in the All-Star game. 2-1.
Good pitch to run on right here.
Great pitch to run on, because last time Leal threw Whitaker a fastball, he deposited over the right field fence. You'd almost have to think he's either going to throw him a changeup or a curveball, which are excellent pitches to run on. And that's part of the game, of course.
Jones doesn't have the type of lead that would indicate he's going.
He can move, though. He had 11 steals last year. Not going. Strike. 2-2. Two pitch to Whitaker. Ball three. So now you know he's going.
He's going now.
Yeah. Right. You can state it emphatically. 3-2, 2 down.
Well, Sparky might have thought that this Whitaker hit the home run last time up. Let him swing and go for two in place of one.
The weave variant theory. Many runs at once.
Fly ball, left field. Dave Collins will put this one away. Tigers are gone, and we'll go to the bottom of the sixth inning. Detroit leads Toronto 5-3 on Monday Night Baseball.
Sounds like there's a bear in the beer.
What are we going to do?
I'll be right back.
Where's he going?
He's going to get that beer from that bear.
That's not just a bear. That's a grizzly.
Yeah, but that's not just a beer. That's fire-brewed Stroh's. I thought we had three cases.
Well, had to make a deal.
Stroh's and Stroh Light, fire-brewed for smoother taste.
Top Chevy trucks.
Farmers know machinery. Our livelihood depends on it. We know trucks, too, because farmers buy more trucks than people in any other kind of business. And we own more Chevys than any other make. Farmers ask a lot of their trucks every day. And when it comes to tough trucks, like this 3/4-ton 4x4, farmers pick Chevys. And we can be mighty choosy.
Tough. That's today's Chevy truck.
A new design in radial tires is rolling your way from Goodyear. Say hello to Vector.
Well, howdy, Vector. I've never seen tread like that before.
Goodyear's new Vector has a unique tread.
Crisscross curves. What are they for?
Traction. All-season traction in snow and rain.
Just what we need around here, Vector!
Plus outstanding mileage down the road. Say hello to the new design in radial tires.
Hiya, Vector! I'm Norm Schechter!
Vector, the new radial design from Goodyear.
Doesn't take long for Sid Mondry to make his Tiger debut. He flew into Toronto today. He had been with San Diego. And let's see, the Padres were home this weekend against Cincinnati, so he's gone the equivalent of coast to coast as he gets set here in the bottom of the sixth inning to face Willie Upshaw. Willie Akins is due up next, but with the lefty now working, Bobby Cox goes to Cliff Johnson as his DA, so Johnson will bat for Akins next. Outside, Upshaw, one ball, no strikes to count. Sid Mondry, no stranger. He's been with California, Cleveland, Philadelphia, San Diego. And now Detroit becomes his fifth big league club, and he's greeted with a single into right center field. And maybe more as Upshaw takes a very wide turn and then holds as the throw comes in. Nice move by Lemon to get over there. He covers a lot of ground and holds Upshaw to one.
Here's the play. Fastball outside. Upshaw goes right with it. Chet Lemon shows why he got so many votes for the Gold Glove last year. He got over there in a hurry and took a double away from Upshaw just as sure as anything.
Clifford Johnson, 279 average, 5 homers, 20 runs batted in. What a difference he made last year. Johnson bothered with a leg problem, injuring his leg yesterday in a slide at New York. In his second year now with Toronto, really solidified things here last year, hit 22 home runs, and Sparky Anderson is going to go to the mound. When Sparky moves that slowly, it normally indicates he's going to go to his bullpen.
Trammell bought some time. He came in between pitches.
There is Willis. Carl Willis is a not only a rookie who was called up last week, but a guy who was picked in the free agent draft last June. So he's been a pro for only a year. And Anderson buying that time and going to the bullpen. So Willis will come in to face Johnson here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Detroit on top 5-3. We'll be right back.
17 hours. That's how long it took us to paint this house with a brush. Then we painted it in just 6.5 hours with a Wagner Power Painter. This wicker chair took over an hour, but less than 5 minutes with a Wagner Power Painter. A shutter that took 20 minutes, a Power Painter finished in only 3. It's a tool so versatile, it has a flexible spray tip and a way to draw paint right from a can. A Wagner Power Painter. It's the right tool for painting.
IBM presents You Make the Call. On a grounded to short, the runner on third base gets caught in a rundown. Eventually, he heads back to third, only to find a runner from second base already there. Which one of the runners is out? You make the call.
In these modern times, even the best manager needs help to succeed. For when pressure builds, it becomes harder to keep things rolling without losing control and falling behind. A manager could use the IBM personal computer for smoother scheduling and greater productivity. It can help a manager become a big wheel in the company. The IBM personal computer at a store near you.
The runner from third base is entitled to go back there if he chooses, even if someone else is already there. So if you said the runner from second base was out, then you made the right call.
Jim Lapley in New York. Down in San Diego, the Braves are trying to move to within a half game of San Diego. But the Padres led 3-2 into the top of the sixth when, with Dale Murphy on base, Brad Comins connected off of Mark Thurman for the two-run shot, which gave Atlanta a 4-3 lead. They're now in the seventh at 4-3. And let's go back to Toronto and Al Michaels.
All right, Jim, and here Carl Willis in the pitch. Willis was with Evansville, and in 22 games there, he was 4-0 with 9 saves. He was drafted on the 23rd round by the Tigers last year. So you talk about all the publicity given these first rounders. Here's a guy on round 23 and in the big leagues a year later, facing Cliff Johnson as he drives Upshaw back to first. Willis, in his one outing thus far, worked 2 1/3 innings against Baltimore. No runs, one hit. Walked one, didn't strike anybody out. Strike here, 0-1.
Threw that pitch hard. And Big Cliff Johnson, who ordinarily plays just against left-handers, really doesn't mind batting against right-handers. Cliff's a good hitter.
He was the Blue Jays' predominant designated hitter last year. Of course, Willis would like to have him hit a ground ball here. He has a good sinker ball. And Cliff is not particularly fast.
18 pinch homers, sharing the league, a major league record with Jerry Lynch, most in a career.
Cliff will break that record before this season's over.
And the count, 1-1. Sid Mangi facing just the one batter, and Sparky Anderson, after the move had been made, comes in. Of course, Anderson still has his two top relievers in the pen, and they're a lefty and a righty, the lefty being Willie Hernandez and the righty being Aurelio Lopez. He gets the ground ball, does Willis. He goes to Whitaker for one, back to first, scooped out by Evans for a 1-4-3 double play.
And what I like most about that play is the way the rookie took his time. Ball's hit right back to him. A lot of pitchers will panic here and throw the ball before the second baseman or shortstop gets there. You'll see he gets himself set and makes a real good throw right at second base. A lot of poise for a rookie.
And Darrell Evans digs it out for the DP. So two down, and up comes George Bell. Grounded out, struck out. Bell batting 337. Willis, 6'3", 210-pounder, born in Danville, Virginia, lives in Yanceyville, North Carolina. He was originally selected by the Giants in June of 82, but didn't sign. Little swiver up the third baseline, foul ball. Interesting parallel there. Dave Rosma was drafted originally by the Giants in 74, didn't sign. Tigers picked Rosma a year later, and he signed with Detroit, has been with them throughout his career. And Willis bypasses a chance to sign with San Francisco, gets picked on the 23rd round, and not often do you see a fella get picked that low and make it to the bigs in 1 year.
Not often. And Candlestick might have something to do with some free agents, high school, college around the country, not signing with that ball club.
You betcha. One ball, one strike, as I'm not sure what Bell is going back for. As we await his return, I can tell you that this ABC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by Stroh's and Stroh's Light, fire brewed for smooth taste. So George Bell, with a count 1-1, goes back up the runway. As you look at Bobby Cox, who can't be particularly thrilled the way things are going for his club at the moment, having lost 4 straight and trailing 5-3 here.
That'd be an equipment problem.
Two out and the base is empty, and here's the 1-1 pitch. Looped down the line, curling into foul ground, and back in the first row it goes. 1-2. Darrell Evans. It's funny, Evans opted for free agency, couldn't get together with the Giants in terms of a new contract. He told me he was worried. He's in his late 30s, worried about being selected at all in the re-entry draft. And all of a sudden he gets a call from his agent and he says, sit down. He said, I got something to tell you. More clubs picked you than anybody else.
30 home runs will do it.
Yeah, he had a great year last year with the Giants.
And he walks a lot. Usually hits somewhere in the vicinity around 275. Not a bad defensive player, whether he's playing third or first.
Line to center field, and that's in for a base hit. So that double play is very big now, sandwiched in between two singles by Upshaw and Bell. Bell at first, two down. Mullinex will be the batter. U.S. Open taking place this week. Late night coverage for you at 11:30 Eastern, Thursday and Friday after rounds 1 and 2, and then extensive coverage on Saturday and Sunday. 18-hole coverage for you beginning at 2:30 Eastern time both days. Rance Mullinex, 0-2. Crowd chanting, we want a hit.
This is a good situation where you can really tell what kind of control a young pitcher has. You have the first base hole with Bell being held on by Evans over at first, and can he make that pitch low and away?
Runner goes, pitches a strike. Parrish's throw is a bullet that is knocked out of Trammell's glove. And Bell gets up, and Bell goes to third. And that's almost a replay of what we had last week when the ball got knocked out of Trammell's glove.
Well, we'll see it here. Got a pretty good jump. Parrish's throw is on the inside of the bag again. Was in the glove this time, knocked out by a hard slide. Get it from another angle. Throw high and on the inside part of the bag. Not a good place for an infielder to have to take the throw.
It's a stolen base and an error. They give him second, and then the error is charged to Trammell. Trying to remember, Earl, if I'm not mistaken, Bell was the fellow who knocked the ball out of Trammell's glove last week at second base on a slide.
I think that's right.
Yeah. Two balls and one strike to count.
Again, we go back to clutch hitting. Collins delivered earlier. For them to get back into the game, need a base hit by Mullinex here.
And he pops it up. Shallow left field. Jones coming over. And Rupert puts it away to retire the side. No runs, two hits, an error, and a man left on. On to the seventh we go. There's the score. It's Detroit 5, Toronto 3.
Steal him! Steal him! Do you know how I can get this big package to Seattle overnight?
Gee, I don't know, Femur. Let's go up and bounce it off Boomer.
Gosh, I don't know, fellas. Let's go up and run it by Rizzo.
Let's parade this past Pooperman.
Let's waltz it by Wimpus.
Let's dance it by Dolt. If more people knew Federal Express handles great big packages, even up to 125 pounds, it sure would save everybody a whole lot of trouble.
Hey, guys, I'm back.
Catch anything, Riley?
Yeah, caught this granddaddy of a fish.
But when I got him in the boat, he says, I'll give you 3 wishes if you throw me back.
A talking fish?
Well, it was hot. I was thirsty, so I wished for a nice cold Stroh's beer. And there it was. Tasted so good, I wished for another one.
2 wishes, 2 Stroh's.
And what'd you do with the third wish?
Hey, would I forget my friends?
Stroh's and Stroh Light. Fire brewed for smoother taste.
boy. Got one. Tiger fly ball going on the ground ball.
Make your father's day. Take him out to a ball game.
Baseball fever. Catch it.
The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
Yankees are coming off a weekend sweep of Toronto and playing well, leading Boston 5-3 ninth inning. Baltimore is leading Milwaukee in the sixth, and the A's are out in front of Texas 3-2 in the sixth inning. Another American League action tonight. And in the bullpen, the rookie left-hander Jimmy Key is throwing back of Leal as we go to the seventh inning here at Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. Game in which the Tigers took an early 3-0 advantage, saw that wiped out on a three-run homer by Dave Collins in the third inning. And then in the fourth, Lou Whitaker hit a two-run homer over the fence in right. And that's the difference in the game right now. 5-3 Detroit, leading by 7 games in the East at the start of play tonight as we go to the seventh inning with Trammell to lead off. Trammell, Gibson, and Parrish against Leal. That's not why they call it Exhibition Stadium. Oh, and one the count. One and one.
Leal's given up 5 runs, all earned, but I think he's pitched a pretty good ball game tonight.
Liner, and that one gets by Griffin. Trammell has a base hit. That's his second of the night. So he came in hitting 346, and that's up a couple of points. National League, Tim Wallach's ninth inning homer, the difference in Montreal's victory. Ninth inning, and the Cardinals are leading the Phillies, so Chicago still stands to remain in first place alone. And the Mets behind Dwight Gooden beat Pittsburgh 3-1. Jesse Orozco came out of the pen in that game to get the save.
Gooden's going to win some ball games in the big leagues.
Elsewhere in Los Angeles, 4-3, the Dodgers leading in the seventh inning. Atlanta, a game and a half back at the start of play in the sixth inning, leading San Diego 4-3. And Mario Soto has not allowed a run through five as it's 2-0 Cincinnati. Now, a visit to the mound by Bobby Cox here in the seventh inning. With Parrish, a right-handed batter due up. Beg your pardon, Gibson. Parrish on deck. There's Parrish right there. Gibson is the next man up, and then Parrish followed by Evans, and he will bring in Jimmy Key. So Jimmy Key comes out of the bullpen here in the seventh inning. 5-3 Detroit. And we'll be back right after this.
This bartender's next big league pitcher. And loves to serve fire brewed strohs. See what I mean? That was his fastball. That was the curve. Look out. Wild pitch.
What was that?
Relief pitcher.
Strohs and Stroh Life, fire brewed for smoother taste.
Hey, chicken's here.
Oh, you went there.
Ooh. Don't we deserve something better?
Yeah,
you do.
You've got a right.
I've got a right?
The chicken done right. The taste it says with just one bite.
It's the one and only Kentucky Fried Chicken. We got a right to chicken done right.
Nobody does chicken like we do with the Colonel's secret blend of 11 herbs and spices.
Kentucky Fried Chicken, they do chicken right.
It's Sears sizzling summer automotive sale. Get the power of Sears 60 battery, now just $49.99. Heavy-duty radial tune shocks, now $9.99 each. 2-ton floor jacks at half price. and Sears Tough New SuperGuard Response Radios, now with introductory savings from 20 to 30%. At Sears, we're installing confidence day and night.
There's more for your life at Sears.
Get the whole story with Howard Cosell on the only regularly scheduled sports journalism series on network television. A candid look at the issues and figures behind the headlines. The Emmy Award-winning ABC Sports Beat.
Jimmy Key comes out of the bullpen. He's pitched better than those numbers would indicate. 2-3, 4.50 ERA. Saved some important games for them early on. And Bobby Cox has not been averse to using him in important situations. He faces Kirk Gibson here, and a good move to first base, but they don't get him. Somehow, some way, Trammell avoids getting picked off. It looked like he was dead.
Excellent move for a young fella. Throw was just on a little bit on the wrong side of the bag, or he was out.
5-3, Detroit leading. Breaking pitch, missing away. Jimmy Key from Alabama. Born and raised in Huntsville. Key, 23 years old. Split last year, 6-5 at Knoxville AA, 4-8 in AAA at Syracuse. That time he had Trammell going back to the bag at first base, and the count is 1-1.
Of course, adds another dimension to the Blue Jays bullpen. They really didn't have a left-hander to come in key situations. I would think, though, Earl, that Bobby Cox, of course, in this situation, when you're already down 5-3, you want to bring in a left-hander that may keep Trammell, who's an excellent base runner, from stealing a base.
It's going to help. And also, I was thinking that Gibson might be sacrificing or bunting for a base hit in a situation like this.
Again, a move to first base. Close.
That's a good move, and you're not going to get a good jump off it. You have to guess with a pitcher like that. Just take off on his first move and hope he don't throw the ball. Hope he don't throw the ball to first base.
Again, he freezes Trammell, and Gibson takes low. Two balls and one strike.
And he squared around. The sacrifice might have been on there. Gibson can run so fast that if he gets down a good bunt, even squaring around, he's got a chance to beat it out.
Lays it down, fielded by Key, throws, just does get him. Gibson really flying down the line. Gibson upset about the call made by Jerry Neudecker at first base. They just do get him.
It was so close. He squared around from a stop position. He just about beats that ball out on a sacrifice. Another angle, and still you can't tell whether he's safe or out. Gibson thought he was safe. Jerry Neudecker thought he was out.
Very close to being a tie. With Trammell advancing to second, so Gibson at least does not spend the time at bat. As he gets credit for a sacrifice, he also has a sacrifice fly tonight, and Parrish is the batter, who's 1-3. Lance hitting 272, 7 homers, 35 runs batted in, and they'll walk him intentionally and get to the left-hand batting Evans in the third period. The Gunslingers are still leading Pittsburgh 14-3. Runners at first and second. Sparky Anderson took over the Tigers in 1979. You know, we were talking with some of the Tigers in the clubhouse before the game, and Sparky is a big hero in Detroit right now, and a man that everybody loves, and who is now in the process of sending Barbaro Garbay up to bat for Evans. But some of the players will remember 2 or 3 years ago, and that town was not very enamored with the old Sparkaroo.
Well, it takes time. You need longevity in a town so that you teach not only your own ball players, but the ball players in the system how to play ball the way you want it played.
35-5, of course, will make you a hero anywhere.
That paid off. Will.
Barbaro Garbe coming up. Cuban refugee. He was part of that Freedom Flotilla in 1980. Has had a stormy past in terms of baseball. There was some question as to some situations that he became involved with in terms of fixing games in Cuba, which came to light when he was playing in the minors. He's been exonerated. Tigers felt that he had a chance. Sparky at one point was talking about him in the same breath as being an up-and-coming Clemente type, Roberto Clemente type. But he's the kind of guy who obviously can hit, and Sparky is going to use him at least temporarily in spot roles against left-handed pitchers.
Well, the scouts must have thought that he could hit, because it's very seldom a fellow of his age gets a chance to, just to be signed in the minor leagues.
One ball, no strikes the count. Takes a strike on the inside corner. One and one.
And that doesn't mean that he's old. It just means that it's very seldom you'll sign a player 26, 27 years old and give him his first start in professional baseball in the United States.
Anderson feels his best position will be first base. He plays first to third, and it's a chopper down to short here, fielded by Griffin. Shovels to Garcia, that's all they'll get as they get the force out. And Trammell now advances to third with Garbe at first, and with two down, Johnny Grubb will be called back, and again the Tigers will go to the bench, and Rusty Kuntz will come up to hit. Here's a guy that was very close to being out of baseball, and it's interesting that he's coming up as a pinch hitter here, because his reputation has been as a defensive player and in a major league career in which he's been up and down several times. Was with the White Sox for a while, but here's a guy who comes up hitting 408. 20 for 49, and doing the job with runners on base.
Well, he's just off to a fantastic start. Another situation ball player. Naturally, you're not going to hit 500 with men in scoring position all year, but he's done it up to this point. Maybe who can say that he wouldn't all year?
Well, again, as you said, a role player, if you can get him up there in the right situation, which. And he's always hit left-handed pitching well, especially the ball out over the plate. He's a very tough out. You can get him up there in the right situation, which Sparky obviously has done, and he can deliver. Maybe that's how you start out 43-14.
Two on, two out. Takes low, ball one. Rusty Kuntz up and down with the White Sox since 1979. Then went to Minnesota last year in an off-season deal. Detroit sent Larry Pashnik to Minnesota to get Kuntz. 1-0 pitch to him, found the way.
They're trying to duplicate the wave here in Toronto, but the fans don't go all the way around the park like they do in most stadiums.
Yep. There we go. We're going to start seeing that everywhere now. I don't know whether that's good or bad. That's a pretty good wave right there. One pitch is high for ball two. 2-1.
Well, the only better wave I've seen is the guy sitting next to me.
Swinging a miss, 2-2.
Hard fastball.
Waves keep rolling in as Kuntz on a hand swing strikes out swinging. So they wave goodbye to Rusty Kuntz at the end of 6.5. It's the Tigers 5 and the Blue Jays 3.
first thing you learn as a professional photographer is don't take chances. It's just not worth it. I'm talking about the paper we have our pictures printed on, Kodak paper, the overwhelming choice of professional photographers.
We ask for it for our personal pictures, too, so insist on Kodak paper.
Wherever you see this sign, and don't take chances.
Sounds like there's a bear in the beer.
What are we gonna do?
I'll be right back.
Where's he going?
He's going to get that beer from that bear.
It's not just a bear. That's a grizzly.
Yeah, but that's not just a beer. That's fire-brewed Stroh's. I thought we had three cases.
Well, had to make a deal.
Stroh's and Stroh Lite, fire-brewed for smoother taste.
This is today's Chevrolet. Here comes the hottest selling Chevrolet today. The fun-to-drive front-drive Cavalier. Fire up 2 liters of electronically fuel-injected fun and experience more horsepower than the top three imports. The minute you feel Cavalier perform, you'll know what makes Cavalier the hottest selling Chevrolet today. A winner. That's today's Chevrolet.
For the Tigers, the two men who pinch it stay in the game. Rusty Kuntz goes into play right field, taking Johnny Grubb's spot, and Barbaro Garvey stays in the game at first base. He batted for Evans. In the bullpen, that's Jim Gott, spot starter for Toronto. Started 6 games and appeared in relief in 3 others who was throwing. As we go to the bottom half of the 7th inning. Ernie Witt with a single and a double. He'll be followed by Griffin and then Garcia. The rookie, Carl Willis, on the mound for Detroit. It's Roseman's game to win. And the count is 1-0. And again, the wave starts at Exhibition Stadium. So the crowd here has a new toy. Foul back. What's amazing is last week we talked about the wave, and they've been doing this in Detroit now all season long, getting a lot of publicity. And we started to talk, Earl, about where the wave was born. I got about 6 letters this week from all around the country telling me it was born at the University of Washington. Another guy said it was born at Stanford. Another guy said it was born somewhere in the South.
I think the first time I remember it was in the Kingdom in Seattle.
Popped up in foul territory. Now Trammell and Johnson, and it falls between them. Trammell had a better angle, and Johnson must have thought that Trammell was calling him off.
Well, that's not like Alan Trammell. He'll usually take anything that he can get to.
Of course, it's so noisy with a wave going around the stands, it might have been very difficult for them to hear each other.
They certainly couldn't bear. There was something wrong.
You make a lot of noise up here. I know I pitched early in May here. And they have some hecklers. Not only do they make loud noise, but they have some fans that can really get on you. Seemed like they used to not care.
Used to be pretty reserved here. 2-2 pitch. Hit sharply on a hop to Trammell, and he throws him out. Well, they used to be reserved here for good reason. The team would always finish last. Wasn't very much to get excited about. And last year, all of a sudden, not only did they escape the cellar, but they were in the race almost all season.
Well, the one night that they got 19 runs in 3 1/3 innings off of us, and I had used 5 or 6 pitchers, I was on my way back to the dugout, and they were all over me, and I hollered at them to be quiet, and they were. So that's
of course, they eventually got 24.
They might have felt sorry for me.
Griffin on a swinging bunt. 0-1 the count.
Carl Willis, the professional for 1 year. As Griffin fouled it away, and the count is nothing and two. I can see why they made a short reliever out of him. He basically is a fastball slider pitcher. And those type of pitchers have trouble if you start him in second and third time around. Left-handed hitters kind of get to you, kind of like Doyle Alexander was until he came up with an excellent changeup for Toronto.
Bobby Cox. The chopper, that is a fair ball. A fine play by Johnson, but the throw is too late. Ball just over the bag at third. And Griffin legging it aboard safely. So an infield single as we look at it again.
Ball's not hit good. Two hopper. An outstanding play by Johnson. Great play behind third base. A Brooks Robinson job, and he's got most anybody on the ball club except one of the speedsters. Get it from another angle here. He came four or five steps and got something on that throw. Would have been an outstanding play if it was a slower runner who hit it.
Damaso Garcia. One and all the count.
Well, he was two runs down last inning, and Bobby Cox was, and he sent the runner.
Griffin at first base, held on by Garbay.
See them coming inside on Garcia. It's just the safest place to pitch him. A lot of times with hitters, you worry about them turning on a ball and maybe in this situation tying up a game with a home run. Garcia likes the ball out over the plate. If you stay inside, he's not going to hit the ball with any authority.
Getting back to stolen base situation, Cox might feel that Willis takes quite a while from the time he starts his motion to deliver the ball to home plate. You might think he has some cinch stolen bases.
Snap throw by Parrish to get him back. And the count, one ball and two strikes on Garcia.
But you're running against one of the better throwing catchers in the American League.
Willie Hernandez is throwing now for Detroit.
What an acquisition he's been.
Got it from Philadelphia. Just prior to the start of the season. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Hit it to right field for a base hit. Griffin takes the turn at second and has to scoot back to the bag. So runners at first and second now in the seventh inning. And the switch hitter, Dave Collins, coming to the plate. With Hernandez throwing in the bullpen, Collins has accounted for all of the Blue Jays scoring tonight with a three-run homer in the third.
Well, here we see indecisiveness on Griffin's part. I think he looked at the third base coach just a little too late. Probably didn't get a signal from the third base coach, tried to do it himself, and almost got thrown out going back into second base.
Really changes the complexion of the inning. Instead of first and third with the first baseman holding the runner on, now he can play behind the runner. Kind of cuts down on the area that Collins has to hit the ball through there.
You sound like a manager. Reasons right now that Sparky might not go to the left-hander is because of Collins' batting average against the hitting right-hand.
And sharply, great play by Trammell to Whitaker for one. That's all they'll get. But a fine play by Trammell off the AstroTurf as that ball just picks up speed and Trammell stays with it. And of course, knocking him down, and he's still able to make the play.
An excellent play. Stayed with the ball all the way. Hard hit. Short hop. Had to go right down with the ball. Did the right thing, made sure he got one.
So runners at first and third, and I think Sparky may have seen enough with Mosby, the left-handed batter, coming up. That'll do it for Willis. And we'll be taking a look at Hernandez coming into pitch here in the bottom of the seventh inning with runners at first and third and two down. Sparky buys an extra moment to give Hernandez a couple of warm-up crosses in the bullpen, a couple of more. Now he's on his way in, and it's Detroit leading Toronto 5-3 in the bottom of the seventh.
Hey, guys, I'm back.
Catch anything, Riley?
Yeah, caught this granddaddy of a fish. But when I got him in the boat, he says, I'll give you three wishes if you throw me back.
A talking fish?
Well, it was hot. I was thirsty, so I wished for a nice cold Stroh's beer. And there it was. Tasted so good, I wished for another one.
Two wishes, two Stroh's.
And what'd you do with the third wish?
Hey, would I forget my friends?
Stroh's and Stroh Light, fire brew for smoother taste.
Say goodbye to America's favorite can of motor oil. That Quaker State quality America has trusted for over 70 years now comes exclusively in this unique, easy-to-pour plastic bottle, made to cost you nothing extra.
So long, spouts.
See you, dirty hands.
Goodbye, oily rags.
No more leaky cans.
Get Quaker State's pen-grade protection and no mess, easy to open, pour, and reseal. Today, you need an oil this good in a package this good.
All the way, support the home team all the way.
Now you can give Olympic gold and silver, because for the first time, the U.S. Treasury is issuing Olympic commemorative coins. They're beautiful gifts or keepsakes, and the precious metal you buy could help win Olympic medals.
Be part of the dream today. Support the home team all the way home.
At many banks, coin dealers, fine stores, savings and loans, and post offices.
Bottom of the seventh inning, Hernandez pitching. Willie has excelled in these types of situations. Two out. He has runners at first and third here. Tying runners at first base. Runner at third, Griffin, who hesitated earlier, otherwise he could have scored. Collins is at first base. And the batter is Mosley. And Griffin been at third when Trammell made the stop and turned it into a force. Jays would have had a run right now. So Hernandez faces Mosby, who's hit the ball to the outfield three times tonight. He's 0 for 3, and he takes high ball one. Willie Hernandez in his 28th game, 28 out of Detroit's 58, so he's worked in almost half. And he's tied with Dan Quisenberry of Kansas City for most appearances. Strike here, 1-1. I'd like to tell our local stations along the line, we'll give you a station break at the next opportunity. One ball, one strike, the count. Go to first base. Nice stop by Garvey.
Well, there's a chance that Collins could be running in this situation. Open up a hole on the infield or get the tying run to second base.
By Hernandez and by Whitaker out into center field. That scores Griffin and sends Collins to third. So two very uncharacteristic plays for Whitaker tonight. He made an error before, and this time he just doesn't get down far enough.
Well, I thought he played the ball wrong. I thought if he'd stay back, he'd get one more big hop. He came in and played it on a short hop, one of the toughest plays in baseball for an infielder. It's a mistake in judgment.
That makes it 5-4. And it brings up Upshaw, who is 1-for-3. And he hits it down to Garvey, and that'll be the end of the inning. But the Jays come up with a run. Three hits here in the seventh. And it's 5-4 as we go to the eighth. Detroit on top, and we'll return to Exhibition Stadium right after this word from your local stations.
10 years after he resigned, Richard Nixon's back. Tomorrow, watch ABC's World News Tonight.
The nation's highest court has decided that criminals cannot be set free because of a police mistake on a technicality. And Michigan school districts are asking voters for a lot more money. Two of our stories right after Tiger Baseball.
Look, they've got three branches in the suburbs.
My goodness, they even have one in Dearborn.
Where's Dearborn?
I don't know.
Since we started Manufacturers Bank over 50 years ago, our ideals haven't changed. But today we have new ideas like our Manuway card. Bank 24 hours a day at over 2,000 locations across Michigan. Old ideals, new ideas. Manufacturers Bank.
That's my bank.
Arbor Drugs Picture Picture, the greatest offer in photo print service since proud grandparents. Picture Picture. Every time you get a roll of film developed at Arbor's already low prices, you get an extra set of prints free. One set to keep, one to give away. And Picture Picture means you always get your prints overnight 7 days a week, or you get them free. And if you're not happy, we'll print them again. Picture Picture, every day, only at Arbor, where we not only sell it for less, we give you two for the money.
On Wide World of Sports, a week from Saturday, from San Juan, Puerto Rico, Edwin Rosario, who's the WBC lightweight champion, will defend his crown against Howard Davis, who is the only gold medalist on our 76 Olympic team yet to win a professional title. He'll have his hands full against Rosario, plus a report on the U.S. Olympic track and field trials. It's Wide World a week from this Saturday. We're going to the eighth inning at Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. Jimmy Key loosening up for the Blue Jays, 5-4. Tigers are on top as we go to the eighth inning. First of a three-game series. This telecast is presented by authority of Major League Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Major League Baseball.
Leading off the eighth for the Tigers is fielder number 34, Chet Lemon.
Chet Lemon, and then Rupert Jones and Howard Johnson are the men due up here in the eighth inning. There's a fellow who has climbed the foul pole in right field, which is the reason for the delay, and not worthy of anybody's attention at this point. As they continue on, the pitch taken low, ball one. 1-0 the count. The game in Boston now tied, 6-6, ninth inning. Baltimore leading, and Texas has taken the lead from Oakland in the seventh. Two balls, no strikes to count on Lemon. In the air to right center field and shallow and dropping in a hurry, and it's a base hit. And it's more as Lemon winds up going to second. So the outfielders tonight, all night long, even with the twilight early on, and now you don't have the twilight to blame or even empty seats back of the plate, getting late breaks on everything that's leaving the bat. Dennis Lamp, the ace of the bullpen for Toronto, the free agent acquisition, is throwing in the Toronto pen back of Jimmy Key.
Wow, one of the hardest plays for an outfielder to make is when the ball's hit off the end of the bat. Mosby's in deep left center. Bell's in deep right field because Lemon does have power. And they take a full swing. They might take a step back or that slight hesitation, as you said, and the ball falls in.
Well, he broke the bat on that swing, too, so it's not going to go as far as it looks like it might with the type of cut he took.
Larry Herndon will pinch hit now for Rupert Jones. Jones tonight was 2-for-3 with a single and a double, and Herndon takes a strike. Herndon has had a tough beginning this year. Tigers collectively, of course, have had a sensational start. But Herndon's hitting only .244 and has no home runs. He hit 20 last year.
Still great to be able to send a hitter like this up to bat this situation. A hitter of his abilities. 20 home runs the past two seasons. because they're going to break out of it sooner or later.
Well, he's been bothered by a leg pull. I think he pulled a calf muscle. He just has been slumping, and as you said, over 90 RBIs. It's a tough out because he has pretty good plate coverage.
Chopper to the left side, surrounded by Griffin, who still is in the dirt. Dugout, runner going to third. Throw is not in time. So Levin alertly is able to advance once the ball left Griffin's hand.
Levin's the type of fellow, when he was at Chicago, didn't mind taking those type of chances. But when he was over there, he was thrown out more times than not every time he gambled. Little maturity, and he's becoming just a little bit smarter. Here's the play. Griffin had a fire to first. The ball was in the dirt, but Lemon would have made it anyway because he left right at the right time.
First out of the inning with Lemon now at third.
Well, Chet Lemon's one of those players that has great speed but not great base running instincts. He's a lot like Alfredo Griffin. Can go from first to third, can score on singles from second base, but when it comes to stealing bases, doesn't have the great instincts. And right there you saw him outrun run the ball.
That was a gamble.
Howard Johnson, the switch hitting third baseman, comes up right-handed for the first time tonight. Only seven at bats, but three for seven.
His gamble forced the infield to play in.
Tigers leading by one as he fouls it away, and the count is 0-1. Chet Lemon at third, one out, eighth inning. Tigers leading 5-4. Good fastball, 0-2.
You know, Sparky said he was going to let him stay in there. Johnson against some left-handed pitching. Big opportunity for him right now.
One and two the count. Johnson, a few times he had an opportunity to get the man in. Successful two-thirds of the time.
Of course, that's a misleading graphic. You don't know if it was in a game where it was 8-0 or in a situation like here where you have the infield in. It's a lot harder to do it here than it is when they're giving you a run because you got a 6 or 7 run lead and it's late in the ball game.
Sure. Also, the league average is pretty high too. Here's the 2-2 pitch, and that's outside for ball three. So a full count. And he went to his mouth, I believe, is what the call is by the plate umpire, Dave Phillips. And if that's the case, that would be ball four. And that's what the call is. So the count would have been 3-2, but he went to his mouth while he was on the mound. I believe that is what Phillips indicated. And that makes it ball four.
That's definitely the rule. Looks like Bobby Cox is telling him he was that far off of the dirt onto the turf.
Well, I've always felt that's a silly rule because it makes the umpire's job a lot easier, but it sometimes can affect the ball game like this. If you're an umpire and a guy's throwing a spitball, which is obviously the reason that you have that rule, you can know it. But most umpires don't either have the ability or the guts to call it. Just seems like a senseless rule.
Senseless rule, but the umpires have to enforce the rules.
So it's a walk, and there the Cardinals defeat Philadelphia. We already told you about the other two games.
Montreal winner,
and the Mets a winner. Ninth inning, Giants batting, trailing LA, and San Diego came back to beat Atlanta 5-4. 2.5 game lead now for the Padres in the National West. Here is Whitaker with runners at first and third, infield looking for the double play, and one out.
Tough man to double up, too.
No balls, one strike, the count. Benitego, here's the 2-2 pitch now. Is 3-2, and here's where he goes to his mound.
And it looked like he was on the dirt.
Strike here, and the count is nothing and two.
Now, after Key got two strikes on Johnson, he seemed to overthrow. His next three pitches were high, hard fastballs to bring the count to 3-2 before he went to his mound. Now he's got Whitaker 0-2.
Trammell up next. And Whitaker takes up and in.
What do you think, Jim? He's reaching back for too much?
It looks like he's trying to get a pop-up. Ernie Witz gave the sign to throw the ball low and away, and he threw it up and in. But again, we're talking about a guy that's only been in the major leagues his first year. It's a meaningful game.
Well, that's exactly what I mean. Now Bobby's trying to tell him, look, you just got two strikes, natural motion. Don't try to get too much for that third strike.
But as you said, as a pitcher, you know if you throw the ground ball, it's still tough to get that double play. You don't want to give up another run, so you're trying for the strikeout.
Well, he's going through his motion right there. He may have injured himself, and they're going to let him take a warm-up pitch or two.
I think Phillips will count that as a trip because Cox never went to the home plate umpire to ask permission to go to the mound. And when I say a trip, you're only allowed one trip to the mound with the pitcher that's on there. The second trip you have to remove. Phillips is saying it's no trip.
So play resumes with a count of one ball and two strikes. Lemon is at third. Johnson at first. Tigers on top 5-4 in the eighth inning. And the 1-2 to Whitaker. Ooh, just outside.
Good pitch. See it again. Nice easy motion that time. It was a little high, probably outside also.
2-2 on the way. Struck him out. Jimmy Key gets a big strikeout. Alan Trammell will be the next hitter. And they're going to go to the bullpen for Dennis Lamb. So it'll be right-hander against right-hander as Dennis Lamp acquired during the offseason. Became a free agent. They picked him up. He spent last year with the White Sox. He'll come on to face Trammell here in the eighth inning.
This is today's Chevrolet. Make your move to Chevrolet's new celebrity. Move into the comfort of more passenger room than 101 out of 106 import cars. Move into celebrity and attraction of front drive. Celebrity. No other new car gives you this much passenger room at a price this low. Celebrity. More to move you. That's today's Chevrolet.
This bartender's next big league pitcher. And loves to serve fire-brewed strows. See what I mean? That was his fastball. That was the curve. Look out. Wild pitch.
What was that?
Relief pitcher.
Strows and Strow Life, fire-brewed for smoother taste.
Golf's elite feel the pressure of a national championship but turn it into performance. Live exclusive 18-hole third and fourth round action at the U.S. Open. One of a kind. Beginning Thursday.
One of the problems the Blue Jays had last year was with their bullpen. Hurt them down the stretch after they'd stayed in the race until the end of August. So what they needed to do in the offseason was go out and either trade for or find somehow a dependable short man, and they opted to go for Dennis Lamp, who was a free agent after spending 3 years with the Cubs and 3 years with the White Sox. And he's done a nice job for them so far. Alan Trammell, who is hitting only 105 lifetime against Lamp, comes up with Chet Lemon at third and Howard Johnson at first base, with Detroit on top 5-4 here in the top of the eighth inning. Teams meeting for the fifth time in the last 8 days, splitting a four-game series last week in Detroit. This is the first of three here. It ends quite a stretch for the Tigers, who just blew away the American League West, getting off to that sensational start. They've been able to maintain a good-sized lead through this stretch against the top clubs in the East.
If the Tigers do that the second time around, if they play the West like they did the first time around, I don't think we'll have a pennant race.
Detroit started out 35-5, and they won their first 17 this season on the road. They send Johnson, and Trammell hits a drive to right field, but Bell backs up and makes the catch. And the side is retired on one pitch from Dennis Lamp. No runs, one hit, and two men left on, as the Tigers cannot pick up any insurance here in the eighth inning. So the Jays come up in the bottom of the eighth. Detroit leading 5-4, and let's check in with Jim Lampley in New York.
Well, Allen, Fenway Park fans got a thriller tonight. The Yankees led 6-3 going to the bottom of the ninth. As you reported, the Red Sox tied it up at 6-6 on a two-run single by Bill Buckner. And then Reed Nichols delivered his first home run of the season over the wall in left field with two men on. It produced a 9-6 Boston win. The winner was clear. The loser was Howell, Gedman, Rice, and, of course, Reed Nichols with the home runs for the Red Sox. Let's go back to Al Michaels in Toronto.
Thank you, Jim. And the Red Sox have now won four in a row and 11 out of 13. So there's a ball club that's very hot. It really has to be very discouraging and depressing to be that hot, and yet if Detroit wins tonight, you're still 14 games out of first place. Larry Herndon, who pinch hit for Jones, stays in the game. He plays left field. Tommy Brookins, who is the best of the third baseman defensively for Sparky Anderson, now playing third. And just in case Hernandez needs any help, you've got Aurelio Lopez throwing in the bullpen.
I've got an amazing stat here with
all right,
the Tigers bullpen.
Amaze us.
The Tigers have only given up 6 ninth inning runs all year long.
It's and let's see, in 57 games.
And
say
I guess
something about Lopez and Hernandez.
Well, they've done the job. That's why there's 19 saves and 11 wins out there.
Of course, they haven't had to. Well, I guess they've always had to pitch in the ninth inning, but a lot of big leads will make it a lot easier to pitch.
And early on, as we stated, they weren't only winning games; they were just blowing people out by scores of 10-2, 11-3.
Leading off inning for the Blue Jays.
Cliff Johnson, the DH, comes up for the second time. He hit into a double play as the wave rolls around Exhibition Stadium. I guess this is something we're going to see, I'm sure, in every ballpark in the country before the season's out. Next chance, we'll give our local stations another opportunity for a station break. A word to them as the 1-0 pitch is fouled away, and the count, one ball and one strike on Clifford Johnson.
What a cut. He wanted to put a run on the board in a hurry right then. We'll get to see it again from the center field camera. Pitch a little bit on the outside half the plate. Cliff gets those arms out, comes off his feet, and down he goes.
Well, Willie Hernandez has an excellent screwball, and of course, after that swing at that fastball, he might be thinking about changing speeds a little bit.
Well, Cliff never got cheated on that one.
Always felt Cliff's a better low ball hitter. Remember some long home runs Not that he hit off me, because I
always
to.
Told you to pitch him up. Just like that.
What was wrong with you, Jim?
Oh, I always got Cliff out. Cliff's a tough guy to face because he always has a dialogue.
Here's the swing again. That high fastball shows Palmer's right again.
Again? Again. High fastball is one of the more difficult pitches to hit in baseball. It's a pitch that the hitters can see the best because it's right up in their eyes, but if you don't hit the bottom half, the ball usually is popped up, or you swing and miss it.
High to Johnson, 2-2. Jim mentioning Johnson normally has a dialogue with it. It's funny, though, he's become sort of the foundation now for this team. He's a month away from his 37th birthday. He's one of the more mature Blue Jays, obviously. But in his early years in the National League, he was more of the campus clown type. Hits it off the end of the bat on a hop to short. Travel with a long throw gets him, and there's one away. Funny how guys go through periods in their careers where early on you wonder what sort of a fella they are, and oft times they can be sort of a bad influence on a team. Not that Johnson was, but you've seen guys through the years spend 8, 9, 10 years in the big leagues, and then all of a sudden they become one of the foundation stones.
Well, that's so right. The maturity, the same. You don't know the mistakes that ball players make as a youngster, but you watch as you spend your time, you see why one person fails, why another succeeds, and if you're fortunate enough to stay around, you can pass that information on to the younger people. And my buddy here did that well.
Well,
he was quite an influence on each and every young pitcher that came to the Baltimore staff. And
only the good ones.
I don't want to blow smoke, but he did do that. But he loved the newspaper people.
Storm Davis loves him, doesn't he?
I believe he does.
Well, I love Storm Davis. I was telling some of the Toronto hitters, I said, Storm gives me a lot of credit. I said, it's kind of easy when a guy's got a 95-mile-per-hour fastball. I just tell him to throw it up high and tight, low and away, and then throw your breaking ball over. All the things that Earl told me.
Bell fouls back the next pitch, and the count is 1-2. Willie Hernandez helped pitch the Phillies into the World Series last year. Jesse Barfield is out on deck. Mullenix spot due up next. And Hernandez missing away with a scroogey, 2-2.
What makes Willie Hernandez successful is that he can run the count to 2-2, and just like he did on Cliff Johnson, and then throw that good screwball. There's a lot of confidence in his breaking ball. And there it is again.
Right there.
And that was a good one.
And as we said, you want to get on top of your breaking ball. It gets right on top of that screwball, and you can see it running away from George Bell.
Batting for the
you can see the lunge, and you can see the strikeout.
Shades of Mike Cuellar.
Jesse Barfield. Last year, Barfield hit 22 home runs in this ballpark alone. This year, he's being platooned. Part of the reason, as we stated before, is that Dave Collins has been so hot. They've got Bell and Mosby in the lineup every day, and they platoon Collins and Barfield. Here's a fellow that they think can develop into a star.
Well, they certainly do. I was talking to Cito Gaston, the batting instructor, and he said, of course, Jesse's only 24 years old, but when you have the year that he had last year, of course, he hit a lot of those home runs late in the season, 27 altogether, and he has one of the best throwing arms and is a fine defensive outfielder. You'd like to see a guy like this play every day, but as you said, Dave Collins has come along and he gives him another dimension. A lot of speed in left field.
Well, we saw the graphic, 22 home runs here and 207 at-bats.
And he was going for one right there. That's one every 9.4 at-bats for Barfield, which means about a home run every two games. At home. Up high. One ball and one strike. Actually closer to every two and a half games.
They respect him because Trammell and Parrish both went out on the mound to give Hernandez, who's new in the league, a little tip as to how to pitch him.
5-4, Detroit on top in the eighth. Got the inside corner to Barfield's chagrin. 1-2.
The pitch was probably a little bit inside, but then again, Lance Parrish, who's catching for Detroit, sets up inside. He gives a good target. And the pitcher sometimes hit that. You get maybe a pitch that's 2 or 3 inches inside. Called a strike.
Missing outside.
There's the screwball again, but Barfield didn't bite.
Count is 2-2. Defensive alignment.
Deep in the outfield, deep, we saw them. They don't want to let that ball get in between them for the extra base hit.
Struck him out on a screwball. And it's a 1-2-3 inning. So the Blue Jays are gone here in the eighth. It is still Detroit 5, Toronto 4, as we go to the ninth. And we'll return to Exhibition Stadium after this word from our local stations.
Sunday, Richard Dreyfuss is a private eye tackling his toughest case, the big fix.
Magical things to see, come on up.
Fabulous things to do.
Come on up.
Memories are guaranteed. Come on up.
History everywhere.
Montez vous voir.
America borders on the magnificent Canada.
Come on up.
Come on up.
This is WXYZ TV, Channel 7, Detroit.
We're going to the ninth inning. Detroit leading Toronto 5-4 as Dennis Lamp loosens up, and we have a moment to check in with Jim Lampley in New York for this update. Jim?
Al, the San Diego Padres entered the bottom of the ninth down 4-3 against Atlanta relief ace Steve Bedrosian, but after Kevin McReynolds tied the game and stole second base, this single by Bobby Brown drove in McReynolds with the winning run that has given the Padres a 2.5 game lead on the Braves, 3 games ahead of the Dodgers, who lost tonight to San Francisco. Now back to Al Michaels in Toronto.
Well, the Padres, after a good start this year, then some problems in May, rebounding now. 2.5 up on Atlanta. Garth Orge comes in to play third base with Barfield batting for Mullinix. Sparky Anderson, no stranger to playoffs and World Series, though all of those were accomplished when he wore red. Guided the Reds to 2 world titles, 4 pennants, 5 division titles. Boston a winner. As you look at the scores, Baltimore 3-1 ninth inning. Texas leading Oakland 6-3 in the eighth. 3 finals in the National League with Montreal, the Cardinals, and the Mets. All victors. Giants with a ninth inning rally beat L.A. San Diego, we just told you about. Cincinnati 2-1 over Houston in the eighth inning. Giants got 5 runs in the ninth to beat the Dodgers tonight. Kirk Gibson to lead off in the ninth inning. Takes low and away. Your man Frank Robinson, Earl, is under some pressure right now.
Definitely is. And Frank, I read an article in the paper. It seems confused, doesn't seem to know what to do about it.
Ground into the left side of the shortstop, Griffin, who throws him out. Nice play by Alfredo. Scooting over to take a base hit away from Gibson.
Earl was hit hard. Center of the plate. Griffin got over there in a hurry. And what I like lately about Griffin is he took his time, straightened up, and made a good throw. When Griffin first got to the big leagues, he was liable to twist and throw that ball off balance. We get it from another angle here, show you just that he got it on a short hop. Man was still out.
One away, and Lance Parrish is the batter. 7 homers, 35 RBIs for Parrish this season. chased a breaking pitch, and the count is 0-1. He's had a tough time. Remember last week he came up against Lamp, and we pointed out the problems he's had with him. 1-21.
It's funny how those statistics seem to stand up year after year after year. Like Johnny Grubb with Liel, first inning,
yep.
Second inning.
San Antonio leading 21-3 over Pittsburgh now in the fourth quarter. One ball, two strikes.
You can kind of see why Parrish is so unsuccessful against Lamp. Lamp was making great pitches. And that's usually the case. As a pitcher, if you make bad pitches, you get a lot of, you give up a lot of hits. I know at one point Rod Carew was 23-46. Lifetime off me. A lot of them were meaningless hits, but most of the time I wasn't making the quality pitches. And also the fact that he's a 331 lifetime hitter had something to do with it.
Good pitch right there. Breaking ball over the inside corner. Parrish may not agree about the call, but he walks back to the dugout now 1-22 lifetime.
Here with that late breaking ball, it just kind of hangs and it's pretty close to being a ball, but awfully close to being a strike. Davey Phillips thought it was strike three.
There wasn't a thing he could do with the pitch though anyway.
Barbaro Garbay pinch hit in the seventh inning and hit into a force. 0-1, batting 313. For the folks tuning in, local news will follow the game, and then Nightline follows that. We are in the top of the ninth inning at Toronto. Detroit leading 5-4, the opener of a three-game series. Tigers trying to stretch their advantage to 8 games in the East. 1-1. Detroit has not won a pennant since 1968. Last time they won the divisional championship was 1972, and then they were beaten by Oakland in a dramatic 5-game playoff. Blue Jays, of course, have never won anything. Just came into the league in 1977. So some hungry fans in both towns. A lot hungrier in Detroit, though, because they go all the way back to the turn of the century. And as we say, it's been 16 years since that team has been to the World Series. 2-2 the count.
I think as a player, Detroit's always been a great baseball town to go there as a player. Of course, they have some great lineups. Northrop and Kaline and Cash and Horton. Gates Brown, who's a hitting instructor for the Tigers.
And it's a baseball park. It's a pure baseball stadium. That's what I love about it. It's foul outside.
Well, you never pitched there. That's why you love Tiger Stadium.
From a fan's perspective, unless you're back of a pole there, it's a great place to watch a game. The wave.
Going to a hockey game where it seems like somebody always stands up when they score a goal. Yeah, I think you can miss a lot of the game trying to be part of the wave.
That's a good point.
Fouled away again.
But all the fans want to be part of the game. The funny thing here in most towns, they do it when the home team's at bat. So far tonight, they tried to help out defensively.
Yeah, it's an indiscriminate wave tonight. Popped up, foul ground, back out of play. Count stays, 2 balls, 2 strikes. When the Blue Jays bat in the bottom of the ninth inning, 8, 9, and 1 due up, Witt, Griffin, and Garcia are scheduled. With Hernandez in there, with a left-handed batter, he'll probably go to the bench. Buck Martinez, in fact, was on deck in the bottom of the eighth inning. And down goes Garvey here. So Lamp does his job, sets down the four men he faces, keeps the Jays right in the game. And there the men do up as we go to the bottom of the ninth inning at Exhibition Stadium with the Tigers in first place in the East and leading here 5-4 over Toronto.
There we were in no man's land when the moving truck died in the sun and the sand. So since it seemed we'd be a while, we set up house and we waited in style. And we waited, and we waited, and we waited. Now I know Ryder and some newer, they're tougher, they're strong. And driving a bargain sure didn't pay, so next time I'll think this way, it's Ryder or it's wrong.
When you buy a new car, you want to keep it looking new. And that's easy with Armor All Protectant. A scientific formula that took a polymer chemist 10 years to develop. It helps keep rubber, vinyl, leather, and plastic looking new. So even though you can't keep your car from getting old, you can keep it from looking old. Armor All. It's science, but it works like magic.
Sail the high seas between Newport, Rhode Island and Bermuda with actor Sam Jones. Here he joins the crew of The Intuition for a thrilling first-hand look at open ocean racing on The American Sportsman Sunday.
And this ABC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by Chevrolet with the performance, the style, the innovation, the quality, and the value that make up today's Chevrolet. And by Stroh's and Stroh Light, fire brewed for smooth taste. We're going to the bottom of the ninth inning, and Tony Fernandez will pinch hit. Buck Martinez had been out on deck when the eighth inning ended, but they opt for Fernandez to try to get a man on base here in the ninth inning.
Well, another reason for the switch is if you had Buck Martinez, who is not fast afoot, get on base, it would, a pinch runner would be in order. You need some speed. So they're hoping that Fernandez can get on. They can't pinch run for Buck Martinez. If he had let off and got on, they couldn't pinch run for him because he'd be their catcher defensively.
Fernandez was called up a couple of weeks ago. He'd been at Syracuse in the International League and is playing back of Griffin. They've been talking about Fernandez as the heir apparent to Griffin for some time now.
Basically a line drive hitter, not a whole lot of power. Can steal some bases, stole 35 last year. There you see the good screwball in the outside corner. Has a lot of talent. Some of the Blue Jays were talking that right now is a lot of kids that are 21 years of age. Doesn't really know how to prepare himself for the game. I think he really feels he ought to be playing, but doesn't know how to go about doing it.
He's from the Dominican Republic, and he fouls the next pitch away.
Well, that's part of a manager's job to let him know why he's here, and I'm sure Cox has had some talks with him.
Tony Fernandez, 21 years old. Lays off the pitch that just misses outside, and the count is 2-2. Bobby Cox will see Griffin come up next.
Get on there, Tony.
Then Garcia. Two to Fernandez. Little comebacker. Willie Hernandez throws out Tony Fernandez, and there's one down. And Alfredo Griffin will be called back. And now we will see Buck Martinez come up to hit for him. We can tell you the executive producer of ABC Sports is Rune Arledge. Dennis Lewin producing tonight's game, directed by Chet Forty. Peter Lasser, our pregame feature producer. Our technical director, Bill Morris. Associate director, John Bassoni. Assistant to the producer, Elise Backus. As Buck Martinez comes up. Martinez, without a home run this season, and batting just 210. Early pointed out in the pregame show that he and Witt provided a lot of power last year.
I talked to him about it during batting practice, and he is very disappointed. But his words were that he got off to a slow start before and doesn't like playing in the cold weather, and it can get pretty cold up here. And he's expecting to bust loose any time. He thinks Whitten himself can still come up with between 15 and 20 home runs for the season.
He's at 10 in each of the last 2 years. 0-1.
Of course, Buck lost a lot of weight. He was never what you would call thin, but he dropped about 15 pounds. He said he felt a lot better, but he just, as you said, hasn't hit any home runs to it up till now.
Good fastball.
Pattern's been the same with almost every hitter. High fastballs, and then when it comes time to get them out, you see the low and away screwball.
No balls, two strikes.
Right here, though, I'd go right back up with the high fastball.
Wasted one away.
Stayed with the pattern. Well, he's having success with it. I don't see why not.
One out, bases empty, 5-4, Tigers. Detroit trying to move 8 games in front. 2-2.
They tried to get him out of the strike zone.
Inside. Baltimore has won. They beat Milwaukee tonight 3-1. They would stay 11 back. Two pitch to Buck Martinez is lifted in the air to shallow center field. Coming sprinting in is Lemon to make the catch. He started in, then slowed up a bit, then came on again to make the play. So there are two down here in the ninth inning.
Here he comes. Lemon gets a real good jump on the ball. And his leg didn't look like it was bothering him there, because that was a pretty good play.
Two down with the bases empty and Garcia the batter. Blue Jays on the verge of their fifth consecutive loss. Tigers trying to make it 5 wins in their last 6 games and 7 of their last 9 after a brief sinking spell. Foul back. It's Rosma's game to win, and Leal, if it stays 5-4, would go down to defeat for the first time since last season. Hernandez trying to pick up his 10th save. That one is fouled away into the seats off of first base. So the count 0-2. Jim, this is the week of the U.S. Open. Our coverage begins Thursday and Friday. Late night reports and then extensive coverage Saturday and Sunday afternoon. 2:30 Saturday and Sunday Eastern time for the U.S. Open. Here's the 0-2 pitch to Garcia. Just low. 1-2. We'll see the Tigers again next week as they take on the Yankees. Some of you will see Texas against the Angels. Garcia staying alive with a count 1-2.
We've seen 2 real good ball games the past Monday night with Detroit and Toronto.
Sparky's loved them. Cox hasn't been too happy about him. By the way, that 19-game one-run winning streak for the Jays, they'd won 19 straight, is now going the other way. They're on the verge of losing their third straight one-run game. As the pitch is outside, they lost 2 to the Yankees over the weekend and are 1 out away from going down to a one-run loss here. Collins is on deck.
How tough it is to get that last out.
but he gets it, and the Tigers lead by 8. Damaso Garcia strikes out as Hernandez does a masterful job. And another look right here.
Well, they've been pitching Garcia in all night. Here it is again. Borderline pitch, but too close to take for strike 3.
So Al Michaels, Earl Weaver, Jim Palmer saying so long from Toronto. A look there at the final score, Detroit 5, Toronto 4. Stay tuned for ABC News Nightline. Tonight on Nightline with Ted Koppel, will America's borders remain open to all? A look at our growing immigration problem on Nightline tonight, immediately following your late local news. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. Nobody knows Hawaii like United. ABC's Monday Night Baseball has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television. This year, the Olympic tradition continues.
Tuesday.
That is his Wilder.
When a reporter goes out to catch a famous star, she could get burned. Hotel, then.
Everything can be had for a price.
The opium dens of China can be murdered. Heart to heart.
Tomorrow, all starting at 9, 8 Central and Mountain.
Well, you saw it. The Tigers are now 8 in front of the Jays and 11 in front of the Baltimore Orioles. Clutch pitching by Hernandez and a great clutch hit tonight by that second baseman by the name of Whitaker. We'll have full details for you. Tonight, it looks like it's shaping up this way, that the problems plaguing that Midland nuclear power plant cannot be fixed, cannot be resolved, and the project, I guess, is going to be scrapped before the week is out. We'll have the story for you in just a moment. Diana?
A major media outlet in Detroit has been sold, and strong reaction to a major ruling by the U.S. Supreme Court. Bill?
Jerry's going to have a look at the weather, and Steve with sports. Diana Lewis, Bill Bonds, Channel 7's Action News Update is next.
Yes, we'll have a pan.